Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Come on and shout hallelujah. To the Yah, Yahshua HaMashiach. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Hallelujah. What a great blessing and privilege that Yah grants unto a nation, a people that He has elected and set them apart for the beauty of His characteristic may be expressed in them, upon them, and among them. For we live in a generation and a time whereby there is a mindset that denounces all that appertains, that belongs to Him, that this generation has no conscience of that at all. So it tends to resist His truth, His Torah. It tends to negate what Yah commands us to do, because we have seen that have risen up in the midst of Yisra'el. It is a mindset and it is a nature of effeminate men. They have not the strength of Torah. They have not the dynamicism of the power of Torah that they are able to stand upon the dictates and the diction of the Torah despite all opposition or what comes against them. They are very fragile and they are weak. They have not the koach, the strength, or the assurance of the Torah. We need that, Yisra'el, above all things. We need the strength, the koach, the strength of the assurance of the might of the Torah. We need that among the nation of Yisra'el. And that is vitally important unto us as a nation, a people. And for the man to have the strength that he has been endowed with from above, not by some damn constitution or some law. It is the law of Yah. It is the Torah of Yah that strengthens the man, because he has the breath of assurance of the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach. And that is simply the truth. We greet you all that have joined us, wherever you have joined us from, our precious Ach, there in Memphis, Tennessee, Ta'on Yah, and they are gathering today. Yah has granted them to gather even in the same hotel whereby the meeting was. They have secured that property so that they can begin to have Shabbat services. And we do appreciate that from Yah. We will get all that information up on site for you in the Memphis or anywhere in Tennessee. You're looking for wonderful fellowship of those of Yisra'el. We will be directing you toward that direction on this week. And also our precious Ach and Zachin there in California, and Brother Charles Davis, as they gather. He said to me yesterday, the other day when we talked, that there are those that are inquiring and want to come. I said, man, open the door. Yah will supply a place big enough for you all to gather. You began to gather. You have the power, you have the beauty, you have the strength, the maturity to stand before them, to exalt, to teach. And then there should be enough resources that you all can find a place for all those that want to come. So we greet you all there in Los Angeles, California, our Ach, Charles Davis, and those that are gathered with him. We greet you all in Yahshua's mighty name. One of the Ach said, on last Shabbat unto Ach, Charles, he says to him, we might as well sit down and settle in and expect that we are not going to go unscathed, because he is going to rip us, he's going to rip you, and above all, I'm going to rip me. If any time we stand in the presence, his ponim, we stand in the presence of his face and we go unscathed, something is wrong. Something is drastically wrong in our conscience. The one that presents unto us the living Torah, and somewhere he is missing the very vital essence of the Torah of Yah. I don't care what he teaches on, what he declares unto us, we cannot go unscathed when we're in the presence of the refinest fire. Can you stand in the front of a fire and expect not to get sparks on you? Can you stand before the wood burning stove? You will stand, most of us will stand backwards for our buttocks to get warm. And all of a sudden you have to rub, you have to change positions, you have to move away a little. And that is the conscience of Yisrael. We began to move our mind away from Yah. We began to move our heart away from Yah. This is Straight Talk 3, straight from the book. Hallelujah. It is the straight talk of Almighty Yah. It is His talk that is Sharad, not Yasha, that is straight and upright. This is the Sharad. This is the talk to repudiate, to correct, to rebuke, to admonish, to teach us, that we be taught, to inspire us, that we will walk in the order, the mandates of the Most High, Abba Yah. And we do all things to please Him. So this is straight talk from the book. And I want to show us an aspect of Yah that we have by our own desire. We have totally deleted that out of our conscience bank, whereby He is not even thought of in this concept. Neither is His HaMashiach. He has been painted unto us this damnable Jesus Christ by the effeminates of the world, by self-effeminate men, and this Isabel spirit whereby declares that Baal is my king. And so it has been taught that it has not reaffirmed the message of power in the mind, in the rush of man. And it has brought him down that he is demasculized. He has no masculinity of strength. He has no warrior power. He has been reduced to an effeminate man. It was one thing about the old fathers of old in the home. There were things that they would not tolerate. They did not allow in their home. Even my grandmother, there were things she would not tolerate. No woman came in her kitchen with painted nails and called herself cooking with long nails. Your filthy hands with all that filth under your nails. You did not dress any kind of way. That is so provocative today that it is abominable. Is everyone trying to draw attention to them for what? Our damnable corrupt flesh. It personifies nothing that is beautiful. That we think we have some great charm and some great beauty. It ought not to be so. And I say this especially among you that are of the diasporas, you men and you women. The women have become so ashamed of their beauty. They have become so ashamed of what Yah has done to them. Let me say this before I go farther. I recall as a young man at 28 years old, what young man does not want to birth a son of his loin, a son to progenerate that specific of his lineage? What man? And I remember the day, and I'm saying this to say I've never charged Yah as though why has this happened to me? What is the reason for this? In all of my ignorance, I did not do that. And I recall it was in 1985, 1986, that my Isha and I, we were at the North Carolina Medical Center for the in vitro fertilization. I recall it quite vividly. The matter of fact, I can tell you what I had on that day. I don't know if she can, but I remember. I can tell you precisely. I had on a cream-colored fedora hat. I had on a red jacket. I had on a cream-colored pair of slacks. I had on a pair of cream-colored Italian loafers. And then I had on a cream-colored shirt. How do I know? Because I recall as we were there in the medical facility there at the University of North Carolina, that they will walk up to me and they would say, you got on the wrong color here. You should have on Carolina blue. You got on the wrong color with that state color red. I didn't care what it was. I simply like that red jacket. And I recall as the humiliation and the shame I felt, the process what they took me through to examine the potency of my body. It was an embarrassing and shameful thing to me. And as I began to look through the catalogs of the process of this in vitro fertilization unto my issue, and I recall rising up to her because I felt ashamed as to what they had caused me to do. I felt ashamed, Israel. I felt very little. I will lie to you not. And I look in her eyes and I say to her, I did not marry you for a baby, for a child. I love you despite whether we ever have a child. I don't want you to go through this process, this cruel thing. I did not go out of there and cry unto Yah, why me? Why is my situation like that? But in all things, I will, my friend. I'm going to preach and hollow today. You understand? I did not charge Yah foolishly because of that matter, because of that circumstance. I was glad that I would not have to cause my Israel to endure even that great agony of pain, even the humiliation and men examining her body that don't even know her. I wasn't, as they would say, I wasn't feeling that at all, Yisrael. And I find this very effeminate generation, especially of men, their shame of their women, their shame of their look. And the women today don't even know how to look, adore themselves in a way that is so beautiful that it defines beauty. Can I give you an example? It is one thing that you will find here in the South, North, maybe in some of the most largest metroplex where you have a tremendous integration of people, especially the Mexicans. We were in the store the other day when we left to go down to Augusta, Georgia. And many times you will not find the Mexicans integrating or even conversating with others outside of their caste system of their mind. So this Mexican woman, she walks up to my Isha and I, and these are her words. Were you saying that to boast? No, I am saying that the people of Yah, there should be an identity about us that that befuddles the minds of this generation. She walks up to us, and her words were this: you all are not from around here. Why is that? First of all, you don't look like us, the people, and you certainly do not dress like us. This is what the woman said. She was dressed just like that, her head covered, full. And yet there was something that was so amazing that this Mexican woman, she had to walk up to us and identify with that. We have become so accustomed because this effeminate type of mindset has been nurtured among us, and the men are so effeminate, they can't appreciate the beauty of Yah. Yeah. Women have gone through tremendous agonies and their bodies of DNA process to promote big bodies and different attributes of a woman to labor. And yet the men today are too damn shameful, and you bath of Tizion don't even know how to accentuate your beauty. You don't give a damn. Yah made you excellent and beautiful in your fashion. It is a damn shame. No, you should not dye your damn hair, man, woman. What a vile, wicked thing. You don't try to alter the process of Yah of your aging. You're going to age and you're going to die. Even in the midst of that, there is a profound beauty. And we're so damn ashamed, and these effeminate men are so ashamed of their woman. I'm not ashamed of my Israel, even with her crippled walk. I'm not ashamed of her. Not one bit at all. I don't want her dressing like the harlots of the world and exposing herself. I said to her this morning, I don't like that showing a little bit. And she pinned everything up. This is a wicked generation. It doesn't give a damn about ya. The men are so effeminate. Their minds have been nurtured by this motherly figure. Not by the strength of a man. And so they don't know a damn thing today. They don't know the beauty of a woman today. They don't understand what accent the beauty of a precious bath of Tizion. And so the women are so damn befuddled, especially you bath of the diaspora. You're so damn befuddled and twisted in your mind because of the images that have been projected in your conscience. You're ashamed. I'm not ashamed. I stand with great boldness and strength. It's amazing that I was looking at my skin tone the other morning. I say, wow, I like the darkness of my skin. I like when it gets dark, because you find these Jezebels today, like the Buances and the Nigers, they are bleaching their whole bodies and dyeing their hair blonde. It's falling out, these damn wigs and horse hair. And you bath, you take that as a pattern of beauty. You're sick in your damn mind. I don't give a damn who you are. You're sick in your damn mind. You're frying it so that you can cook chicken on it. He gave you some beautiful hair, bath. He gave you beautiful hair. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. There's nothing ugly about you. You have made yourself ugly. And hell, no man is attracted. The men of the diaspora, they're not even attracted to their women today because they're so effeminate. They're so fake. And the women don't present any kind of beauty. I was talking to this akh here. We talk in the gym. Yes, I go to the gym. And I will go there until I can't go anymore. And he was talking about the essentials of beauty of a woman, and they think they understand, but they don't understand a damn thing. You understand? So the world has projected this false delusional image upon them, and they really think that they are attractive, but they are not. I have an old wife. We both are old. I'm gray. But yet, when one will say, you don't even look like us around here, and you don't even dress like us, nothing fly. No diamond rings, no diamond watches, no jewelry, or no earrings. I will, man. Not a breast hanging out, a titties hanging out. She's trying to look hip-hop. I want her to look her age. I don't give a damn whether you concur with me, whether you appreciate what I say. I'm showing us how our minds have been so riddled with such concepts of folly and ignorance. We don't even know what the beauty of Yah is. If we saw Yahshua coming, we would reject him. And this is the torment of even the mind of the effeminates. You understand? I was reading the article the other day whereby now this gay, or this coming out of this gay superhero, and all of these men that design what we call the superheroes, they are gay men. They are gayish. That's why you should not have your sons and daughters playing with damn baby dolls and all these damn action figures. Get the damn mess out of your damn house. You don't let them play the gay video games with these damn action figurines and all that. Get the damn mess out of your house. This is satanic, it is witchcraft, it is not of Yah. It is vile, it is unclean, and you do not subjugate your sons to that damn mess. They don't walk around with a damn teddy bear like a little effeminate thing. You subjugate your son, well, he's been sleeping with that sister child, take it away and burn it in the fires of hell. This is straight talk today. Yeah, this put us in a fix here. Hallelujah. It shows us what we're lacking, Yisra'iyah. Straight talk, when we're in the Sarah, it presses upon us. It presses in a way that we are enemies. And we are enemies of Yah when our minds are not constructed by the commands at Almighty Yah. And you women of the diaspora, you don't set a damn example for the bath for the little ones like that. They don't even understand what beauty is because you're so damn ashamed of it. And you men don't teach your sons the power of beauty as you embrace your wife in a natural element of her beauty. And hell, they grew up without understanding what beauty is. It's this damn superficial hybrid creation in their mind what beauty is. And then you wonder why bath our women are manless without a husband, because hell, they are no men. I'm not backing down for one of you. And I don't give a damn if you don't appreciate me. Or I'm going to show you a side of Yahshua HaMashiach you haven't seen. These little effeminate men, they teach this little passive side. But I will show you something out of the book. Huh? Hallelujah. I will not allow it. I will warn Yisrael. And to warn us is to nahah. When you're warned, you are rebuked. You are reproved. You are chastised. That's what warning is. It is to give you advice. It is for you to be taught. It is to teach you. It is to scrutinize you. That's what the warnings are. The naha. It is to make an alarm that you will check yourself out. And we need to check out our wicked ways that we may teach our young bath, our babies, the beauty and the essence of Yah and Yahshua that dwells in your bosom, you Yeshua. And you men, we must teach the beauty of strength, not only to our sons, but to our little bane, our babies, so they will know the beauty of a strong man. I can't stand an effeminate man. I don't like that spirit. I don't even want to be around a man that is effeminate. I don't like to be around a man that's full of what the Torah talks about, sports, folly and laughter and clowning. I don't like that. In the world, I didn't like it because I've always been wickedly sober. I don't like that. I don't like that grinning and skinning and laughter about every matter. It's not of Yah Yisrael. He tells us all came to be sober and to be vigilant without all of this damn foolishness. So you wonder why the house is in the shape it's in. I want to read something. This straight talk today. I want to show you an aspect of Yah and an aspect of Yahshua HaMashiach. It says here in the book of Me'aseth Shilishim, the book of Acts. Shaul, he discloses here unto the Zacchaean of Ephesus or Ephesia. He speaks unto them as he knew that his time was bearing upon him, and he knew that his time upon and fellowship with them would expire. So he wanted to leave a lasting impression. The book of Acts, chapter 20 and verse 28. I would have began there. Five verses I want to read. Four exactly. First of all, Shaul tells them to Shema, Acts 20:28. He said, first of all, take heed therefore to yourselves. You need to govern yourselves by the Mishpat or the Mishpatim, the judgments of Yah. We must constantly judge ourselves, our motives, our intent, our desire, our passion. He said, take heed to yourself and to all the flock. You take heed to the flock. You observe, you are a watchman. You are one that oversees and look. Isn't that what a watchman and the tower watch for? He watches for the wolves among them and to watch for the integration of things that ought not to be. Yeah? He said, take heed over the flock, over which the Ruach, it is not man that places a man over the heritage of Yah, but it is the Ruach HaKadosh has made you the overseer. He said, it's the power of Yah that has given you the authority to watch over them. To feed the congregation of Yah, which he has purchased with his own dam. We must feed. Yah says, I will raise up upon among you the Reach that will feed you with da'at, knowledge, and bin, understanding. The power to discern, the ability to take the wisdom of Yah and utilize it, that you may develop the characteristics of Yah, which is the revelation of Yahshua HaMashiach. Is he not the Word made flesh? Yeah. He said, you have been made an overseer. Most of these men today have been given charge by effeminate men that sat on the women, that given their strength over to women, and they are part of that little emotional, effeminate gyration, and their actions are effeminate as well, Yisra'iyah. He said, I want you to take heed above all things. Yah has purchased this congregation. It is not you that have purchased the congregation, Yah himself. He has purchased Yisra'iyah. He says this, look at verse 29. For I, Yada, I know. That's why a messenger must warn. He must zaha. He said, for I know. It is factual. For I know that after my departing, he says, shall vile, grievous wolves, they're going to enter in among you, not sparing the flock. And it's one thing that the wolves, when these wild pack of dogs found entrance among our sheep, they did not go toward the big ram. They destroyed the most vulnerable ones. And they butchered what, about 14, 15 of our lamb? He said, they shall not spare one. They shall come among you, wolves. The spirit of this omnivora, it is effeminate, it is natural, it is secular, it is a carnal thinking that has this connotation of some spiritual strength. They're superficial, they're false, Yisra'iyah. That is the connotation of the wolf. He will eat anything. If it's rotten, the dog will eat it. He said, they're going to enter in among you. They should not spare the flock. This is what has happened, Yisra'iyah. Also you, also of your own self, shall men arise. They're going to stand. And they're going to speak leasing, perverse, wicked, unclean things. They love to joke and jive. Everything there's some kind of humor with it. Speaking perverse things. Everything has an aspect of humor. No. Would you warn someone, there is no aspect of humor to it? Yeah. None whatsoever, Yisra'iyah. He said they're going to speak leasing. They're going to speak perverse things to draw away disciples after them. They're going to draw away men by their lies and their corrupt talking. The ability to soothe the wicked, wicked practices, and will not warn us of the impending power of judgment that shall come upon us. Straight talk, I will get to the straight talk, but I want to lay this down and show you the entrance of the spirit that has come in and to bring great demise among Yisra'iyah, to cause our minds to resist the truth, to cause our minds to reject Yah and far removed from him, that we get upset when Yah speak to us. But I will show you some things about Yah today. You can get mad, I don't give a damn. You can get upset, it doesn't mean a damn thing. We better know this one that we are serving. We better understand his ways and know what pleases him. We've been hoodwinked and taught lies. I've been a part of that lying teaching. And you have been receptive to the lies. It's now that we redeem the time. I want to bring it out. He said, also of your own self men shall arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after them. But this is what he commands us. Therefore, watch to observe. Verse 31, watch. And he said, I want you to remember. I want you to remember that by the space of 3 years, I cease not. 3 years? 3 years? By the space of 3 years, I cease not to warn everyone, night and day, with great tears. He said, I warn you. But yet, although my warning, this is what's going to happen. Can you imagine being warned night and day, day and night? And every element of this Shaul's teaching was to warn this people to Zahat, teach them, to reprove them, to rebuke them, to admonish them, to enlighten them, to correct them. Can you imagine for 3 years, by the space of 3 years, Yah caused him to sit among that people and to warn them 3 years, and yet the prophecy of the Nada was prophesied, but after my leaving, there shall arise among you men that are corrupt. They're wolves. They are men that of the sadistic mindset. They are carnal practitioners that's trying to convey a spiritual pattern and a lifestyle. He said they shall rise up out of the midst of you. And so he warned the Zakim to watch. To watch. To take oversight over Yisrael. When you see certain elements of infractions against Yah arise, and you repudiate. You warn the people against that. You tell them of their folly, their sins, and their lies. And you must be a man of a certain characteristic. An effeminate man, he doesn't want to deal with anything that offends him and deals with the weakness of the aspect of his life. But it's worth thinking about a strong man. He wants the challenge because he knows that even as he gets old, it makes him stronger in the days whereby he doesn't have the power of his youthful strength. And that's what we need today. No doubt about that. I shall preach, man. I didn't intend to preach, but I'm going to preach. Hallelujah. He said they're going to rise up. I want to take us through expose of the mind of Yah, his character. And those that truly have the fear, the power of Yah in their loins, they have the testimony of Yahshua. The testimony of Yahshua has been construed in the teaching of this vile whore. And we think we understand, but I will take you to the prophets and let them tell you and give us some aspects of Yahshua HaMashiach. How about that? And that's how the faggots justify themselves. Quote, they will say, quote, Jesus taught love. Unquote. Isn't that amazing, Ma'ach? That a boy can butcher his mother, bludgeon her with a baseball bat, and they will say that he was a loving boy. He loved his mother. You can find a man that will go in the house and kill all of his babies, boom, 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 kill his wife, and they will say he was a loving man, but yet he will not kill himself. You will find men that will take advantage of, solicit and rape their own daughters and say that they, and he was a loving father. And that's a fact. This damn thing we call love, don't love me with, I don't want nobody, don't tell me you love me. It's corrupt. I will know you have love for me when there's a beauty of Yahshua's testimony in your life. We are people that do not hear. I say things and I say, listen, listen, you all hear me. And we get offended, don't we? We get offended. We get upset. We don't like to be told that. But Yahshua said, 3 years plus I talk with you all. And I'm telling you what's going to happen. We are an ignorant damn people. We're stupid. The people of Yah, we're satish. We're ignorant. We're stupid. We get offended. We don't appreciate the love of Yah. Every son that he receives, he corrects. He moves on, he counts them. And we are so effeminate that our feelings are so effeminate. We're so feminized and so effeminate that we offend it so easily. I never let a man, I don't give a damn who he is. I don't care what his circumstances is. I don't care what his trials, his affliction is. I will never let a man play that pity my circumstance. You don't understand lies. There are those out there on the great agony of pain, and hell, you live rich, you live fat, you can eat, and you're going to tell me it's me. Damn you! I will not buy it. I will not buy it. There are women out there that are brutalized, so brutalized that their minds and their consciences have been scarred, so not only physically but mentally have nowhere to stay tonight. You're going to tell me about your little sorrows? Damn your sorrows. Damn your agonies. Damn your complaints. Let them be damned, and you as well. I will not complain. I will not murmur and murmur before you. I appreciate all he does, every trial, Toda, every affliction. As I said to you all, I would say to my mother, before she died, I said, you wore me out. But there were times you should have whipped me, you did not even know. Because our judgment of sin is not expediently rectified. Because he doesn't judge us immediately, because he gives us space to repent, then the heart of man is fully set to do evil. Because we say, oh, nothing happened. You see, and a man always, a weak man always looks for one that is weak like him. And he looks for a woman, and they have this connection. As Kephas says, husband, deal with your wife according to knowledge. You deal with her with the knowledge of the mind of Yahshua HaMashiach. He said, and love her, because knowing that she is the weaker vessel. You deal with her, you warn her, you teach her, you show her. We're held to men, to the men, what call themselves men today, they are as effeminate, as weaker as their wives or those that are associated with her. And that's a fact. I will, man. I don't care if people don't like me. I don't care. I don't want their love. I don't want this damn false thing you call love. I don't want you to love me with that. I want to move here. Was that we not known? He was not he the apple of Yah's eye? I want to read what he says here. Hallelujah. He reads, this is a prayer of Dawid here. And this is his attitude. This is Yah's attitude. And Dawid, as he speaks in the book of Tehillim, Psalms 5:3. He knew that Yah would hear his prayer because he was a man that would confess his ills and his sins. But look at what he says here. I want you to hear this carefully. He says, Psalms 5 and verse 3, he says, my call, my voice shall hear you in the morning. This is Dawid now, Tehillim 5:3. He says, oh Yah. He said, in the morning I will direct my tefillah or my pala, my prayer to you. He said, and I will look up. When you cause me to rise, I will cry out unto you, Yah. This is Dawid. He said, for you are not a mighty one that has pleasure in Rasha, in sin. He has no pleasure in wickedness. What is Rasha? Not Rasha, but Rasha. It is a mind. It is criminal activity against the Torah. When we defy the Shabbat, we defy his name, we defy the mitzvah of Yah, we are damn criminals. He takes no pleasure. There is no hafetz. I don't give a damn if they're 10 or 99 or 110. He takes no pleasure. I don't give a damn if it's your mama, your grandmama, your granddaddy, your daughter, your son. He takes no pleasure in the Rasha. This is thy wheat. Now listen now. Listen to this. For you take no pleasure in wickedness, neither shall evil dwell with you. No ra. Whether it is spiritual or morally decrepit devices of wickedness, he said, no evil, no ra shall dwell. We are a nation of people, we do things morally wickedly. We do things that are spiritually wicked. We are immoral toward Yisra'iyah, but we're intrigued by the damn wicked. And those that have no love for Yah, you know you have no love for Yah when there's no power of his testimony, his edwuth in us. This is Dawid. He's talking to Yah in prayer here. Hallelujah. He says that in verse 5, the foolish or the halal, the foolish, those that celebrate folly. You got those that celebrate folly and wickedness. He said that the halal, the foolish, shall not stand in your ayin, in your mental. They have no presence in your mental or physical, spiritual presence. They shall not stand at the fountain of the living water. They will not be able from your ayin, from your shua, drink from the wicked. Those that do evil shall not be able to stand in his presence. He says this. He says, Yah, you hate all workers. You hate all workers. You hate all workers. You hate all pa'al. You hate all workers of iniquity. Those that practice wickedness, those whose mind is Torahlessness. I know what the world say. It says he hate all works of iniquity. No, he hate workers. And if you define the word worker from the Merriam dictionary, it is defined as those that have skill or skill set to practice or to labor in a specific. And when a man labors to work wickedness, he is a worker. He has become a practitioner. It is not that Yah hates his damn sins. He hates that man. He hates that woman. He hates those. Well, what is of on? What is of in? What am I? When a heart is so adamant, it rejects the discipline of the Torah. When a heart resists what the Torah commands. An ovon or ovin, it is a mind, it is a conscience, it is a heart that is Torahlessness. There are no attributes of Torah in that one. They talk a nice damn wicked talk, but there's no substance there. As the old ones would say, you got to do more than talk to talk. You must walk the walk. And so when Yah says, when David said, I know Yah, this is what he said, I know you. Hate all workers who create projects, who build, who construct things outside of the mind of Yahshua HaMashiach. Because it is all shav, it is all vain, it is worthless. It doesn't mean a damn thing. When you take his name for vanity, you exalt a damn Jesus, a damn Baal, a damn wolf, a damn dog. You are afraid to speak against it. You have fear in you because you don't have the power of Yah. For the perfect love of Yah casts out all fear. When you get the love of Yah, you know you have the love of Yah because you love his commandments. This, you know that you love Yah if we keep his commandments. You don't keep his commandments, you don't have a damn thing. You have this pseudo-superficial, this pagan, homogenized thing you call love. I don't want you loving me with that damn stuff. It's wicked. It stinks to hell. It is vile. It is corrupt. There are men that start over their baby and say, I love you, baby, and go boom, boom, boom. The men that stand over their wives and say, I love you, and butcher them for the insurance policy. And people will testify he was a loving husband. The boys that butcher their parents and they say he was a loving, obedient child. When a mind is Torahlessness, when the construct of that mind is not based upon the principles of the Torah, it is a mind of Ovin. And Yah hates all workers, all that construct and build, not their works. He hates all workers of iniquity. And he tells Yah, he say, you shall abat, you shall destroy. Yah is going to exterminate. He's going to kill them, their babies, their wives. I want to show you an aspect of Yah. He's going to kill them all. He says, you shall destroy them that speaks kazab. That's why we have to be careful. We're going to be judged by every idle word. Your kazab, you speak lies and you know that you are lying. You speak untruths. You speak lies against your neighbor. I'm talking to Yisrael. I'm not talking to this damn wicked world. I'm talking to the house of Yisrael. Damn this world. He's going to destroy them that speak leasing, that love folly and frivolity and jocularity. We as men, let us get that damn mess out of us. He said, all that speak kazab, they speak things that are so deceitful, full of lies. They have lies in this mind that is Torahlessness. Doesn't have the power and the discipline of Torah. It has no witness of Yahshua. He's going to kill them all. He's going to kill them all. And these same beasts, they produce children to hate Yah. They produce children to hate Yah and their sons. And their daughters are cursed. Can I say this? I'm going to finish today. And I got 5 pages of scripture. I'm going to finish them all. I'm going to move. I remember as a young man, my natural brother, he was a man that was very eloquent in teaching. He was a man like no other man I've ever known that could teach from the book. I was ignorant. He was ignorant, but his teaching to me was so profound. And I remember one day, if there has ever been an utterance of the Ruach HaKodesh, I remember being with him at his home. He was trying to repair his truck. Listen, if the Ruach has ever caused anything that has dwelt in me from a child, from the birth of my inner womb, that day, the Ruach, as it caused it to come alive, he shall never fix that truck. It shall never run again. And then it directed me to his daughters. Look at their hair. That's what the Ruach. Their curse, even their hair, is curse. I was ignorant. I didn't understand that. But today I do. You try to come in any other way, try to build a vehicle to transport you into the spiritual realm. It's not going to work. It's not going to work. And that's the truth, Yisraya. All of that had grave spiritual ramifications for me to understand. And I see them more clearly now than I saw them in that day, because I was ignorant, I was young, I was dumb, and I was full of dumbness. I've never been a man of leasing and folly and playing and grab-assing. That's never been my forte. I've never liked that, because I don't play. Hallelujah. He said, you shall destroy them that speak lies or kazab. Yahweh, look at this now. Yahweh will abhor. I wanted to define that word above all in the Hebraic sense. Abhor is ta'ab. Listen now. Yahweh will abhor. He will ta'ab. It is to be detested. Listen, when you see the word ta'ab, you see the words abhor, it is ta'ab. Now this is the definitive of that word in the Hebraic expression. And also I will give you the synonym of the English vernacular as what it implies. So Yah says, I will abhor, I will ta'ab. It is to be detested. It is to be detested with intense dislike. So when one has an intense dislike, you know what that is. It is an intense now, not just a dislike. There are those that dislike individuals. They don't even want them in their presence. They don't even want their name spoken. It is intense. It is rivet with intensity. It is an intense dislike. It is one that denounces. It is one that condemns. Yahweh will hate. He will hate. And the synonym of that in our English vernacular, it is that he will sone. He will hate. So Yahweh abhors the bloody, the wicked, the bloody, the sinful, the bloody, and the deceitful, the no'atz, the deceitful, lying man. He hates them. He hates the lies of this damn Jesus. He hates them. He hates them that promote a damn lie and reject Yeshua. He hates them. He hates the damn work of the lies and the work of Jesus. He hates them that work it. He hates them. Well, what we have done, we have embraced every damn thing that is against our Abba. Excuse me. Hallelujah. I'm going to preach today. I don't care if I get sweaty and wet. Hallelujah. Makes no difference at all. I don't care if I perspire under my arms. You see the wetness. It makes no difference at all. Hallelujah. I'm not here to make a statement of fashion. I'm here to fashion to Asa, to fashion our minds with the will of Yah, that we do what is pleasing unto him. How about that? Hallelujah. So we hear this heart of Dawid, which is the attitude of Yah. We see Yah's attitude right here. Now let us examine Dawid's attitude into Helium. Psalms 139 verse 17. Psalms 139 verse 17. Quickly. Hallelujah. We must have the passion. We must desire to be led aright, my Zachin. We must desire that to be led aright. As my grandmother would say, in this way of life, there's some hard turns and some hard knocks. Nobody wants the hard knocks or the hard turns. There's some hard knocks in this life. And David, as he speaks of his hatred of sin, the deplorableness of sin, its wickedness, its vileness, and his passion to be led by the light, or the light of truth, his awe, the illumination of this word, that the power of Yeshua is so real. Yes, Yeshua is real. He's real in my nephesh. I can feel him. We need to get to that point. Will you tell me you can feel love, you can feel pain, and there is no pain? You tell me we cannot feel or sense the power of Yah operating in us. The power of his truth is such evident that there is nothing can destroy the element of that power. We become so effeminate, we become so weak. Can Yah find a man among this damn wicked generation? He needs a man. He has always used a man. He has always looked for a man. There's one thing about a strong man, he will set a woman in her place. She will. He doesn't abuse her, but he set her in her place. He sets a woman in her place. I do not garner many friends. That's all right. But I'm going to preach. Look at what David said here in Tehillim 139, verse 17. Excuse me. He says unto Yah, how precious also are your re'ach, or your thoughts, Yah. Your purpose, what you desire, what you are aiming for me, how precious. Are they not precious? Are not these the thoughts of Yah? Are they not precious? How precious. They have great value to me, oh Yah. He say, how gadol, how great is the sum of them. He say, how great is the rush. They mount up to the heavens. How great can you value the sums of the thoughts of Yah? Do you understand what went into the legality and the legitimacy of this? Do you understand the dynamics and the power of what's in that? We don't, Yisrael. How great is the sum of the thoughts of Yah? Let there be light, and there was light. He caused the trees of every kind to yield forth seed after his kind, and to produce those after his kind. How great are the sum of your thoughts? When you speak to me, the value of that is beyond comprehension, is what he says. Verse 18, he said, if I should count them, they're more in number than the sand. Can you imagine just a bucket of sand? Can you imagine taking a bucket of sand and just take your handful and count it? You think that you can count a handful of sand or a cup of sand in a few hours or a day or two or three days? You're silly. This is the sum of the thoughts of Yah. They're beyond comprehension. That's why we need the mind of Yeshua HaMashiach. We don't need a mind that is Torah lessness, a mind that rejects Torah, rejects the definitives of what Yah, the actualities, and that which cannot be altered at all. When Yah speaks, he speaks with definity. It is summed up, it is reckoned, it is settled, and there is no other alternative. There is no alternative to the Shabbat of Yah. There's no alternative to Yeshua's name. There's no alternative to the name of Almighty Yahweh. None. Not a damn Baal, not a damn God, not a damn Jesus. These same damn hypocrites, I call them hypocrites. They get out here on the corners and thump the damn Jesus talk, and they all got Hebrew names. And they will tell you, we speak with a language that is not our language, but yet they have the ability to construct Hebrew names for them. And yet they are, or exalt a damn pagan Latin lie of deception. Jesus is a damn lie. And you're not going into the kingdom. You that love that lie, it's a damn falseism. I don't give a damn what you think. I don't care if you're 109 or 19 or 9. It makes no difference at all. You cannot have fellowship with Baal. He's a damn Lord. It's a damn corrupt thing. And because you don't give a damn, you don't love nobody, you're offended and afraid to speak against it. I am not. I know I'm going to die, but in your time, I'm living to live. I try to keep myself strong, not in the physical sense, but in the spiritual sense. I got work to get done so that I can take time to study and delve into the depths of the riches of the sum of the Rush. When he said the sum, he's talking about what's in Yah's mind. That's why he used the word Rush and the sum. What's in Yah's mind? Can you imagine? Man, with all of his powerful technology, cannot get to the scintilla of what's in the mind. He cannot sum it up in Yah's mind. He cannot tell you the actual kind. You think that any man can tell you the sands of the sea? That's what Yisrael, we look like the sands of the sea. You tell me, is that many people in the earth like the sand of the sea? We are silly and we are dumb. We are stupid because we've been taught by a dirty, filthy whore. We don't know how to, understand the revelation of that. You tell me there are more people. You go, I tell you what, you go down to Myrtle Beach or around here, you take the black hole and you get 2 or 3 yards of sand. That's more than the population of the earth since the beginning. I will guarantee you that. And so you tell me that it's a number that is associated with Yisrael. It is like the sands of the sea. It is like the sand of the sea. You can't tell one drop from the other drop. This whore has messed us up. And that's a fact. We've messed up all of us. I'll show you what we have too. Can I break this down, Mazachim? I will. Let me move quickly. He says, surely, verse 19, surely you will. Look now. He said, you will katal. You will slay. You're going to kill. This is Yah. This is an aspect of Yah. You're going to kill the wicked, the Rasha. Oh, Yah. Depart from me, therefore, you wicked men. He say, Yah, you're going to kill the wicked men. Those that are criminals, they act out of a criminal mind of enmity. They hate you. They hate Torah. That's what a criminal is. When one is Rasha, when one is wicked, they have denounced Torah. You denounce Torah when you denounce his name. You denounce his Shabbat. You denounce the order of Yah, his Mo'adim, his Chag. You denounce him, Yisrael. You think you're getting by, but you're not going to get by. You think that he's going to make room for you and pity you. You're wrong. He says unto Yah, surely you will katal. You're going to kill the Rasha, the wicked, O Yah. So that we said, I know Yah is going to kill you. He said, depart from me, therefore, you wicked, you men that are damned. You bloody damn dogs. He said, get away out of my sight. Get away from me. For they speak against you wickedly. They speak against Yah. They speak against the beauty of his name. They exalt the name of Jesus. They exalt the damn gods and the damn Baal. That's wicked, my Zaken. They speak against you wickedly. A mind that is so wicked that they literally plot against you. They speak against you wickedly. He said, and your enemies, you are those that watch to do you wrong. Your enemies take your name in vain. If they take the name of Yah in vain, they're Yah's enemy. I don't give a damn who they are. I don't give a damn if it's your mama, your daddy, your granddaddy. You can stand for the wicked. He's going to kill them all. He's going to kill you too. I read it again. They are the enemies of Yah. They plot. These bastards are plotted. They're mamzia. They're bastards. They have no spiritual heritage. They're not even the ger. A ger is a stranger that without any inheritance rights unto Yisrael. These are the mamzia. They're bastards. They are the bastard slip. You can coddle them. I will not. I will not coddle them. Listen to this again. He says, for they speak against you wickedly and your enemies and your enemies. He does not even call them his oyeb. He calls them Vast difference in an oyeb and an An is one that plots. When your enemy plot against you, you better get ready. They are the they plot against Yah wickedly out of a mind that has no knowledge of Torah. Your enemies, they take your Hashem, the name of Yah, in Shav. They say it is empty, it's not worth a damn, it's falsehood, and it's worthless. And you dwell in the camp of beasts, of dogs, of idolatrous wickedness like that. I will not do it. I will not. You can, but I will not. This beast over here in Europe writes me a letter where you should salute every man. If you salute those that are just of you, then the strangers do that. I salute every man. What is a salutation? How you doing, sir? Everything's well today. I salute all men. I do no man wrong. I do no man wrong. No man. I've done no man wrong. I've done no man wrong. I can say it profoundly. I've done no man wrong. I've done no man wrong. I've told him the truth. The enemies of Yah, they take his name in vain. You damn Jesus thumpers, you enemies of Yah. An enemy, you are enemy, you are the heir, you plot against his name, they plot against the beauty of his name, they plot against the mitzvah of Yah, and they're your friends, they're not my friends. Any man that is a friend of the world, he is an enemy of Almighty Yah. You cannot be a friend of the world and say you love Almighty Yah. He said, your enemies, they take your name in vain. And Dawid says, do not I hate? Do not I saw nay, they are your Oyeb, they are your enemies. Do I not hate them, O Yah, that hate you? Well, Dawid was a wicked man to do that, wasn't he? He expressed, no, he wasn't. Listen, he's expressing the same mind of Yah. Did not I read how Yah hated? Dawid said, I hate them, not their works. I hate them. I hate them. I hate them. I hate them. This is what he said. Listen now. Listen, he was not a wicked man. Y'all did not reprove Dawid here. I will show you. He said, I hate them. Dawid said, do not I hate them. Do not I hate not that but them. Tehillim 139, 121. You haven't even come to the completion of the fullness of the state of Dawid. Hell, you don't even hate your sins. The fear of Yah, first of all, is to hate evil. Yes. To hate pride and to hate arrogance. To hate the froward mouth and the evil ways. That's the fear of Yah. You don't even hate that. How in the hell are we going to hate someone that hates Yah? You don't even hate the wickedness about you. I will, man. Tehillim 13, tell us what the fear of Yah is. You don't even have the fear of Yah. We don't even have that. That we say, do I not hate them, O Yah, that hate you? Am I not kuts? Am I not detest? Am I not grieved with those that rise up against you? His enemy, does an enemy rise up against you? When you're an enemy of Yah, you rise up against his name. You rise up against his order. You're trying to overthrow his kingdom. You're an enemy of Yah, Yisrael. I don't give a damn how you say it. How can you dwell in the same bed and sleep with those that despise Yah? With that, my mama's going to hell and so are you. That's my sister. Yeshua said, hell, who is my mother? Who is my sister? Who is my brother? Those that hear the word of Yah and those that do or have the pledge of Yah in them. Damn them all. You hate them. No, I don't know how to hate like Dawid. I wish I did have that hate. I don't have that. Because I am a child. I am a little boy that Yah is trying to train. Walk right, boy. He's trying to teach me how to walk. He's got to change my potty. He's got to take the diaper off my ass and change it because I defecate on myself. This man said, I'm grieved with them. I'm kutz. I detest it. I'm grieved with those that rise up against you. And then he says this. Listen to this in 22. He said, I saw nay them. I hate them with a take lith, with a perfect. I hate them with the perfect. My heart is perfect in your order. My communication with you. He said, I hate them with a perfect sin, a perfect hatred. It is exceedingly, it's beyond my ability to express. I'm so glad that Yah grants unto us, we that will take time, you that listen, that will take time and examine every aspect of the word of the Torah. We have been hoodwinked. We miss the process, the processes. We miss the value of the important things by one word. Can I say this and I'm going to move on? I recall as a young man, I was ignorant. I'll never forget. I go into the bedroom, the little room we had furnished and fixed beautifully for Evangelist Hartsfield. And I recall knocking on his door one morning around 8. He was on his knees And he was studying the book that way, and he had his finger pointing through words. And I said, oh, I'm sorry to interrupt. He said, come on in, Brother Roberts, come on in. Come. He said, read this for me. He said, do you understand that? Of course, I will not answer his questions. He said, read it again. Read it again. And then he put his finger on the one word. One word that amplified everything that was there in that text, in that khatuv. He put it under one word. Without that word, you will not even understand. He has hidden the power of his lats or the secrets or the mystery in the writing of this book. In each word, because we don't examine the words. Life and death is in the power of the tongue. We're going to be judged by every idle word that we speak. Every word that we speak, Yisra'ya. And when he showed me that, I said, I could see a light. And I was, that time, I was ready. He said, explain that, and I did. He said, that's it, son. This is the catalyst here. And you will miss that if you're not careful. So I'm careful with words. People read things and they want to show you what they know. So they want to come to you and say, no, let's go back. No, let's understand the contour of the nature of this expression. Don't come to me that way. Something weak. He said, I hate them with a perfect hatred. He said, I count them my enemies as well. You tell me those that are trying to overthrow your kingdom, you don't count them as your enemy. You're not observant of them. You don't watch them. Because mama said, oh, I love you, baby. Sister, oh, I love my. I got a natural sister. And every year at the time of the day that I was birthed on, she calls me. Or sometime I say, don't call me with that woman. Well, you know, I just love you. I want to tell you this, you damn hypocrite. Don't tell me that. You're full of folly, full of lies. You don't even know what love is. I said, don't tell me that, woman. Don't love me. I said, well, then don't love me. I don't want you to love me. Well, I love you. You're my brother. You're not my sister. I'm not ashamed to say that. I'm not fearful of that. How can someone love without keeping the commands of Yah? Herein is love, that you keep, you shema, you guard the commandments of Yah. I came from a loving family. You came from a damn dysfunctional, hypocritical family. They may have had an emotional attachment to each other. They're brothers that would turn in brothers to get a reward. They're brothers that would sell out one another to get a lighter jail sentence. And that's a fact. That is the same God of love a faggot has for another faggot, or a damn butch bulldagger has for another bulldagger. It's not the Ahab or the Ahava of Yah. And that's a fact. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now he said, I hate them with a perfect hatred. I detest them. And then he says in verse 23, he says, Yah, I want you to ha-ha, search. I want you to search. Listen, the word haka is, I want you to search me with intimacy, with love. Search me, search. Come on, not just search me, but haka. Ha, haka. To search me with great intimacy. To search me with truth. He says, search Yah. I want you to examine my bosom, investigate my thoughts. He says, search me, O Yah, and Yada, my love. Try me, Sarah, put me in the fire. Try me. This is a man talking to Yah. Try me. Try me. Try me. He says, and Yada, know my thoughts, my actions, my sa'af, what I think. He said, and I want you to ayin to see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way, in the Torah, see the way. Derecha or the way ha derech, the way ulam viet everlasting. He said, search me. Now that's a powerful station. Powerful statement that you could say to Yah, search me. When he talks like this, and then he says, search me. This is not wickedness talking. This is a man when he's refined. That's why he said, try me. Put me in the fire. Put your word to me. Put the test of the sum of your mind to me. I stand, Yah, in my statement. Because this has not been generated by my own conscience and my own concept. It has been generated by the sum of your thoughts. It has come that way. These are the enemies of Yah. They love their damn gods, but they don't love you. And we stand to strengthen the damn wicked hand. Woe unto you, hell awaits you. I will show you, hell awaits you. In hell, you shall lift your eyes. In the darkness of hell, you're going to lift your eyes. And that's a fact. In the lake of fire, you can talk that talk, but that is somewhat, it is somewhat of a figurative state. Let it be then. You're going to find out, all right? Hallelujah. He is not a man like us that he must answer to us. Can I ask you a question? You that are listening, you that are here, those that are in the supervisory roles on your job, do you answer to them or do they answer to you? You answer to them. When you all go out to harbor business and to generate business, do they answer to you or you answer to them? They will say, I want this, this, and that. And do you say, no, you don't need that? You answer to them. They have a power in their purse to hire you or to reject you. And you want them to know that you will answer to all of their needs. We must answer to all that Yah commands us. We cannot dissect it and take out a little here and reject that. We must eat the whole loaf. Yahshua is the breath of Lechem of Yah. These damn weak, cowardly things that call themselves men. I hate it. I see it everywhere I go. I see the cowardiceness of them. I see the weakness of men. I say, yeah, I don't want to be like that. I don't want to be like them. I want to be like Yahshua. I want to be more like him. I want to show you some aspects of Yahshua that you just don't know. You read this thing and you do too. And you arrogant ones as well, you just don't see it. Because you're trying to prove a point. I'm trying to prove him. I'm preaching today to prove him. I have no point to prove. Hallelujah. He said, I hate them with a perfect hatred. He could speak like that. For out of his loins came one. His name was Shlomo. He said, there's a time to love. There's a time to hate. There's a time to mirchaya. Is not that a time to love? He said, there's a time to hate, time of war. He said, also, there's a time of shalom. There's a time to love, and there's a time to hate. There's a time to fight the battles of Yah, and then there's a time of shalom. We must stand and fight for Yah. We must stand and fight for this Melchut. We must fight for his name. We must stand for his name. We must denounce everything that is trying to take the light away from you. And you stand and you honor that damn there, Jesus. Damn the white Jesus, the black Jesus, the Jewish Jesus. Damn the Mexican Jesus, the Korean Jesus. Damn all of their Jesus. Damn Jesus. Damn their gods, your belly god, your chocolate chip god, your damn ice cream god. Damn them all, the god of your belly, damn them. No, my ignorant friend, not dam, not dam, not blood. Even the Torah call them bloody men. This damn fool writes me and say, well, you use the word damn. Well, did not that we call them bloody? Yes. Bloody men, they're condemned, damned men. In Britain, they say, you bloody man, you damn man, this bloody beast. Hallelujah. So that's what we have to have, those that will labor to get back to some of the original identities. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hear this, Yisraya. Write it down in the book of Sharach. Sharach 32, verse 2. I read this often, and I'm going to read it again. Sharach. The book of Sharach, chapter 32 and verse 2. It says, a wise man will not sonhi, will not hate the Torah. But a woman is wise, a man is wise, but a child is wise. They will not hate the Torah of Yah. They will not oppose the Torah. But he who is hypocritical about it is like a boat in the storm. You would tell a wise man when there are correction. It is one thing that the Torah brings all the time. It is correction. And a wise man will not hate those corrections, but those that are hypocritical, they're just like a boat in water. So what they would do, they will test one another. They will test those and to see what their response is, so they can carry on with their damn wickedness and their folly. And they want others to do things that are egregious unto Yah, that they can continue their damn wicked paths. You understand? That's what they do. What do you think about that? No, what do you know about that? Because they're trying to feel you out to see if they can get you to subside with them, can keep them in the damn wicked and weak ways. I'm one that is straightforward. I shoot straight from the book. I don't give a damn about your sobbing, your emotions. It doesn't mean a damn thing to me when I see the tears of your show for a damn wretched thing like us. He has laid down his life. You caught up in your damn childlike emotions, damn you. You turn people off, Yeshua turned them off. Because they were wicked. So wives would use their weak husbands. Well, what do you think? Well, and weak men will use their weak wives, knowing that she is weak, and taking advantage of that. Her strength is multiplied by the strength of the man. Not the abuse, but his power, his rush, his head. So he puts her in an awkward position. And because he is so weak, she puts him in an awkward position. Because I do too. Because he want to cater to his own damn emotions and his weakness. I don't want no weak man going to battle with me. No weak man. Get away from me. It has nothing to do with your physical strength. That means nothing. I'm talking about a man that will stand. When he's done everything to do, he still stands. When all men oppose him, he still stands. When wife, children, granddaddy, mama, daddy, he still stands. When all men stand against him, he still stands. He stands in the truth. When mama forsake him, he stands. When daddy, brothers and sisters forsake him, he stands. When all of that which he is accustomed to, he is attached to, when all of that forsake him, he still stands. He stands in the strength of that one testimony of assurance. And he doesn't bow down like a damn coward. That's why I like the warriors of David. One day I'm going to, you all can teach that and preach it. One was the name of Mahalaya. You would think Mahalaya. You would find out all you can about Mahalaya. We hear things and we don't hear a damn thing. I say to my issue all the time, we hear, you didn't hear me. You didn't even hear me. You missed everything I said. You said that. No, I didn't say that. I said this. We don't hear. Just like last night, people think they hear. First thing Yah says, hear my statutes and my judgment. We must be judged in order to hear Yisrael. And that's why this whore has taken away all judgment, hasn't she? This wicked whore we call the church has taken away any kind of judgment. It's all about what we call prosperity, esteeming yourself and lifting up. It's nothing about judgment. But I will show you Yah's judgment. Can I move a little farther? I will, whether you concur or not. See, a wise man will not hate the Torah, but those that are hypocritical about the Torah, they are unstable as ducks water. They go, they fluctuate back and forward. They're unstable. Hallelujah. I want to give you a word of assurance here, Yisrael, to show you an aspect of Yah. I know we have read this countless of times. Not only I, but the Zakin here, you have read it. But I want you to approach this one verse here in Dibarim, two verses, Deuteronomy 5 and 9, Dibarim chapter 5, verse 9. This is what Yah says to us. Dibarim chapter 5, verse 9. He said, you shall not bow down yourself to them. Who are them? To gods. To the black Jesus, to the white Jesus, to the Jew Jesus, the Korean Jesus. Do not the Koreans have their own places? Do not the Mexicans have their own whole houses? Do not the blacks have their own? Do not the whites have their own? Do not the faggots have their own? You don't bow down to them. The faggot Jesus, the bull dagger Jesus, the white Jesus, the black Jesus, damn Jesus. Hallelujah. He said, neither should you serve them. He's talking to the men now. We men must be strong.
He says, for I, Yah, is this Yah talking in the first person? Is this I? He said, for I, is not that the first person? He said, for I, Yah, your Abba, he says, I am Kana. I've always said that jealousy, I don't understand that, but I know that it appertains only to Yah. He is Kana. He says, I am a jealous sovereign master. I am jealous. I don't understand. It has nothing to do with this little frivolous thing we call jealousy. But he says, I am Kana, I am jealous. And for me to explain that to you, you will never understand. That's what Yah says. So I use the word Kana. This belongs to me. Everything that is mine is mine. I don't share it with no one. He says, I am Kana. He said, I'm so jealous. He said, I will parkah. Listen, I will visit. I want to define that one in the Hebrew. He said, visiting, parkah. He said, I will punish, I will appoint, I will assign, I will lay upon as a charge. You hear that? He said, I will pour out, I will visit the iniquity of the fathers, of the Avad, upon the bane, the children, to the third and the fourth generation, to them that hate me. Well, how do you know man hates Yah? When he denies his name, when he's ashamed of his name, when he does not honor the name of Yah Yahshua, when he calls upon a damn Jesus, they hate Yah. Oh, she got love. She doesn't have a damn thing. She has a duplicity, a false thing you call love. And because our minds are so damn twisted, we don't know what love is. We don't know what love is. He said, I'm going to visit upon the fathers, upon their children. Parkat. They're going to be punished. I don't believe that. You don't have to. I'm going to punish their children because they hate me. He said, it's one thing that I know that Abraham will do. I know. He will teach his sons and his daughters and his house two things. He will teach them justice and judgment. We as Yisrael, if Abraham taught his house that, we must be taught the justice of Yah and the judgment. I don't want your damn twisted Yah love. You love this one and dislike that one? I will, man. You embrace this one and then disdain for that one? You care for that one and don't give a damn for this one? You embrace this one with great reward and then you don't give a damn about this little one? I don't want that damn trash. You love yourself with that. You with you most of the time. Love the one you with. Just love you. Don't love me with that damn filth. I'm not going to stop using the kind of superlatives I use and my verbs, my adjectives. I'm not going to stop using them. Damn this wicked generation. Yah says, I'm going to visit the iniquity, the ovon, the wickedness of total lustness upon your children to the third and the fourth generation of them that saw me, that hate me. And then he tells us, you fathers, he said, I will show Naham, Mahasit, mercy to thousands of them that love me. How do you know you love him? And keep my mitzvot. You wonder why things are happening today. Yah is killing them in the belly. Yahshua is destroying them. We don't believe that. I know we don't. He is appointed to kill my bad. I'm telling you. We don't read this enough because we don't love it. Yeah, I'm talking to you. You don't love it. We don't study this book. Hallelujah. And when the power of this ovon began to rise, you will find that people, there's a distance between them and the house of Yisrael. But they love the wicked because they're part of the wicked society. They love wickedness. Yahshua even spoke of that. He said, we're coming to a time. And I want to get into the depth of this to show us the attitude of Yah in the time that we are in. I want to show you characteristics of Yah and Yahshua in this time. But I want to read this quickly in the book of Lucas, the book of Luke, chapter 16 and verse 13. Because Yahshua, he reproved the Pushim and the Safarim for their covetousness, their greed. And Yah commands us that we should not covet Yisrael. We should not covet our neighbor's substance, his ass. Nothing we should covet. And so Yahshua speaks of the defilement of the Torah here in Lucas 16:13. He says, no servant can serve two masters. How in the hell you going to call on the name of the Lord Jesus and honor the Lord Jesus? And those that honor that, you honor them. And yet you don't even honor the name of Yah. You're trying to honor the name of Yah. It's duplicity. It's a hypocrite. You're just like a ship or a boat without a rudder. You don't know which way you're going. For either look now, he will hate the one and love the other. You're going to either love Yah and hate God, or you're going to love God and hate Yah. You're going to love Jesus and hate Yeshua, or you're going to love Yeshua and hate Jesus. Damn Jesus. Damn Jesus, the image, the name, the spirit. Damn Jesus. Or else you will hold to one and despise to other. He said, you cannot serve Yah and mammon. You cannot serve Yah and wealth. You cannot serve Yah and the things of this world. Isn't that what these whorehouses are teaching? You cannot serve Yah and serve your own passion, your own desire, your own corrupt desire. You cannot do that, Israel. It's just not going to work. And the poor Shem also, who were covetous, heard all these things, and they began to deride him. See, we will deride Yeshua. When he speaks to us, we will speak in our anger. We will speak in our hostility. We get upset. They began to challenge him, began to question him. They began to deride him. They began to reprove him. They began to show him his limitation. We will push him. We understand the dictions and the dictates of the Torah. They began to deride him. And I watch men do that in their expression, their look. You say something. Why? Listen. I will be a damn fool, even those that have lived here, those that have been here and that worked among us, to do things to destroy the bond of Yisrael. I will be a damn fool. Because it is the resources of their faithfulness above all things, their labor, their kindness, that brings about the vision or the power of the vision. So I will be a damn fool. But I'm not one that is cowardly, that I will not reprove the sins and expose the wickedness of man. I'm not that way. And I watch them deride me in their look, their action, their words. It's a damn shame. It's a wicked shame. You look at their brow and what's between. I say, what a damn shame. This man says he loves me. This man stands on our rostrum and talks and esteem, and this is what this damn boy is doing to me. What a damn shame. I will, man. What a cowardly spirit. Hallelujah. Can I move, please? So they deride him, verse 15. He said to them, he says unto those, he says, you are they which justify yourself before men. That's what we are accustomed to. Lucas, we like to make ourselves, we like to esteem ourselves before men and to make ourselves look as though that we're right. He said, you're the one that justify yourself before men, but Yah knows your levim. He knows your heart. He knows what's in you. For that which is highly esteemed among men, that which you exalt, you esteem greatly. He says, it is an abomination in the sight of Yah. That which is given the greatest of great reverence. That which is esteem among the world, Yah says it is vile. It is it is an abomination, it's filthy, it is a perverse thing. It is unclean, Yisrael. And he gives them this word of wisdom. The Torah and the Navi'im or the Novi, the prophets, were until Yahkahanan, until Yahkahan the immerser. He says, Since that time, since Yahkahan, he said, the Melchut of Yah is preached, the kingdom. Now that's what I want to show with the kingdom, how the kingdom is devised, how it is brought to its stability and strength. There are things that must come out. He said, the Melchut of Yah is preached, and every man press into it. So they tell you, just say bye and bye, how we overcome. You must press. You must press. Those things which are highly esteemed, you know they're filthy. Your damn family gut cooking, cookouts and all that, it's filthy. The damn family days and the birthday celebration, the funerals and all of that is filthy. It is full of folly. It is full of drunkenness and whoredom. They dress like damn whores and faggots. The faggots come at everyone. It's an abomination. Put them in the damn ground, what you do. You don't bring that damn filthy thing in the house. We've done it in ignorance. We will never do it again. I don't give a damn who dies. It's wrong. You come to the knowledge of the truth, you don't strengthen that which defiles Yah. If you're part of the pagan order, then you participated in it, not I. I won't do it. I will not do it. The Torah and the prophets were until Yahohanan. Since that time, the Melkut of Yah, the kingdom, is preacher, and every man pressed into. You got to press. You must press. You must press beyond. You're not pressing. You must go beyond your own limit and your own limitation. It's like one that has never bench pressed 300 pounds, or they get to that point where they can bench press 300 pounds, and then they build through applications and workmanship, and then all of a sudden it comes to that day. And then that first time they do with such explosiveness because of the nervous reaction, they just boom. Then after that, all that nervous strength is gone. Then you get down to the real deal. You get down to the raw deal then. And then when you drop that down, you realize it's not coming up. So you got to press. And then when you press all you can, you got someone we call a spotter that say, come on. So we must press. It takes the faithfulness of one another that we may press into the kingdom to strengthen one another. So your boys say, come on, get it on up. Come on, you got it. Huh? Then after that press, you're lightheaded, headache, and everything. Your body aches for a week just on that one attempt. So we must press. The kingdom of Yah suffered violent. It's a great attack. And we that are going in, we must press in. You're not going in like the whore told you, huh? Oh, Hakadore. Everything is sweet cotton candy. You're not going in that. You must press in. And those that are going to enter in, they must press in, Yisraya. We must press in. He says this, it is easier. It is much easier for heaven and earth. You hear this? Listen. Not for a wicked man, but it's much easier for all of Yah's creation to be dissolved than one tittle of the Torah to fail. Do you hear that? It's easy for all that he has by the sum of his mastery created, for all of that to fail, than for one small atom of the Torah. You reject the Shabbat. You reject his name. You reject that. These commandments that shows a great love for Yah. You reject it. You reject it. You call on the damn Jesus and you honor that damn lie. He said, all I've done. He said, that is easier for that to be removed than for one fraction of the Torah to fail. It's not going to happen, Yisrael. You can pump all the damn Jesus talk you want to. You can keep your Sunday worship, which is wicked and wrong. I had someone to call me and say, Reak, I want to ask you a question. They attend this place whereby the leader, they become so desperate that they want to have a service on the Shabbat and then the Sunday too. I said, I will not participate. If a man is that cowardly weak, he think that it's going to draw the people. I don't care if it's 10, 20, 50, 100 of us in here. It makes me no different. How many men, most men would be discouraged with a little small crowd like this. But I come to warn you, to naha, to admonish, to teach, that you may be taught the truth of Yah. I'm not discouraged. You taught me long ago this one thing, son, don't be discouraged. You're going to find few there be, but don't let that trouble you. And I'm not trouble at all. So open up the house to the heathen practice, and then you will find one like that speaking against the Shabbat next. No, I will not participate. I said, you may, but not me. I find that to be a weak constitution. There is no absolute absolute in that individual, and there is no resolute because he is defying the Torah. I can see if you having service every day, that's all right. If you're in a place where you're gathering, you're going to preach for 2 or 3 weeks, that's all right. But to say we're going to go with an extra service on Sunday is not to have a midweek service. It is to draw that Sunday crowd. And you're really ready to compromise. I won't compromise. Damn their sun worship. It's wrong. It's wicked. It's vile. It's repugnant. There's no day. He didn't even tell us to have it on Wednesday. He told us to remember Zachar HaShabbat and keep it kadosh and keep it set apart. I'm doing a research on the Sanskrit language. I will teach that one day or write a booklet. It's going to bless you much. I'm not a lazy man. That I'm not. When it comes to laboring in the fields, laboring in the Torah, I'm not lazy. I'm not that way. I make no excuses. I said yesterday, I said, oh, I'll take advantage of this day, but I had to work and got the things done that I don't have to get done next week. So I can get things done next week, get on that fence over there and fence that for the garden so we can have food to eat. You understand? And hell, you all get out there and pick it. You understand? This is a damn lazy generation. Our men are lazy in their mind. We're grotesquely overweight. We won't even bend our backs. Our women are sluggish and they're lazy. That's just it. I'm not taking that back. They don't have the spirit of the old ones. Fans and air conditions have messed us up. We can't even stand the sun. And the sun is not our enemy. It feeds our bodies with vitamin E. Keeps your skin looking young. Just keep it black and glistening. I want mine black. I'm not looking to light mine up. How about that? Can't even stand the sun, so tender. And this is something that God's given you for a great resource. You don't have to buy vitamin E. Hell, get out there in the sun. Let the sun hit your back. Let the sun bear down on you. And the air conditioner has got this artificial mess, has gotten us so messed up we can't even stand that. Got to have fans blowing on us. And we wonder why our body's in the shape that they're in. I'm not going to stop that, Yisrael. And I'm not going to stop talking about our undisciplined ways and our actions. We should help one another. If this one is undisciplined, man, help your wife. Woman, help your husband. How can you as a messenger, as one that reprove, repudiate the house of Yah, when your own damn house is not disciplined, when there is no order in your own, you can't do that. It must be. The power of your head must be represented in your ish. In your ish, Yisrael. That's your strength. She's the vitality and the vibrance of your strength. I know we don't want to hear it. But you don't give a damn about her. You don't care. I don't ever want to be like that. I will, man. Nobody has to say all my anger. Well, hallelujah. Shut the damn devil's mouth. Cannot go around. Torah of Yahweh, you cannot go around. The word of Yah, I'm not here to pacify you. That's why we are fat and greedy and lazy and sluggish. That's why we are sleepy and full of poverty, because we always want someone to speak gentle to us. I'm speaking gentle to you, showing you the mercies of Yah, warning you of the impending destruction. I think that's a fair man and an honorable man. Hallelujah. I'm not taking nothing back. I don't give a damn. Is this Zakin? I don't care. Zakin Yarabiyah makes me no different. If I love him, I tell him the truth. If I don't, I would say, well, I don't want to tell him. That. No, I'm telling him now, before all. I don't give his, my Akh Yusuf, yeah. Come on. Makes no difference. Hallelujah. It is easy for heaven and earth to pass than for one tittle of the Torah to fail. So you tell me, you're going to do this right here, thou shalt not take the name of Yah, Shav, to make it empty? You tell me that's going to fail? You tell me this commandment right here, the fourth, remember the Shabbat? All four of these commandments deal with these mitzvot, deal with loving Yah. And these six right here deal with me loving you and showing you how to love you. I can't covet your neighbor's house. Come on. You think you're going, one small infraction is going to cause that to fail? Everything he's made will fail. He will burn it all up before that fail, because that is him. That is his pleasure. If you don't do that, you're not pleasing Yah. You please your damn corrupt old flesh, but you're not pleasing Yah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are just like Thyatira. We are this, we have this Urus, this Oduras, of this Urus affection for everything but Yah. Was not Yahkahar on the Isle of Patmos for the revelation of Yahshua? And when we see that in the writing in red in the book, that means Yahshua is speaking, right? I will read something what Yahshua says here. Cannot go around the Torah of Yah. Cannot go around the Torah of Yah. Hallelujah. Let me find this. In the book of Gilead, Revelation, chapter 2, if you look from chapter 1, verse 11, is that in red in your book? It's from verse 11, that's red. And then you look down to verse 17 to, and all the way in chapter 2, all of that chapter 3 onto chapter 4. Is all that in red?
Yes.
So that implies that these are the words of Yahshua HaMashiach. Does it imply that? I ask you a question again. Is it red in the book that you have? Now, some of the translation, it may not be red. But in this one, it is red. This is the first book I ever preached out of. This is the first book that I preached out of. Is it not read there? So it's read there. And most of them, they will differentiate when Yahshua speaks than the chronological of the event. Is it not read there? Is it read in yours? Is it not read? So we know that this is Yahshua. As he speaks unto the seven, the complete perfect order of the assemblies unto the house of Yisrael. So this is Yahshua speaking, right? I want to show you what he says here in the book of Thyatira, in the book of Gilead, Revelation chapter 2, verse 20. This is what Yahshua said. Is this not Yahshua speaking? Is it read in your book, Ahod Raphael? Who else have the red writing? Is it read in your book, okay, Ima, Yosef? Who else? Yours too? Okay, Ima, yours? All right, give me some hand. Is it read in your book back there? It's not, all right. It's not read in yours, but it's read in, is it read in your book? Is that read? All right. So basically we see it in the red print, right? Now, if it's read, we know that this is the verbiage and the speech of Yahshua. Look at what he says here in the book of Gilead. This is not the Yahshua that we want to know in what we call the Brit Hadassah. He says here in the book of Gilead, Revelation chapter 2, verse 20. He says, notwithstanding you, Oris affectionate whore. He said, notwithstanding, I have a few things against you, not for you, but against you. Revelation 2, 20. He said, because you suffer that woman, Isabel, the one that says that Baal is her king. You say Jesus is your king, that's Baal. He said, you suffer that woman, Isabel, which calls herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit zana, to commit fornication, to practice idolatrous worship, to bow down before Jesus and the cross, to bow down on sun worship and to honor Easter and Christmas and the damn pagans. You have taught them fornication. This is Yahshua. He said, I got a few things against you. Oh, he is just so pretty and living. He said, I got a few things with you. He said, and you cause them to eat sacrifices to idols. When you gather for your damn family days or your family reunion, you're sacrificing to the dead. They have a chronological lineage, and that's all it's about, your damn wicked family. I will never. The last time I participated was nearly over 25 years ago. When I left the place, I got a ticket. I've never been back to another one. I got a ticket. Over 25 years, the last ticket I've had. We've been married 35 years, so that, yeah, I got a ticket. I've never been back to another one. And never will. Who is my family? Those that hear this Torah and do the will of Yah. The same is my Ima. The same is my brother. They that don't hear, they're not my family. You can lay hold to them. I won't. He said, they either think sacrifice the idols. You go there and, baby, you know I'll celebrate Christmas. But here, baby, just take some of this. I know you don't, but take some home and you eat that damn mess. I've heard those say, well, you know, Yah just led me to go to my mother-in-law's house. I know it's Christmas, but he opened a way where I could talk about Yah. You didn't say a damn thing. Well, my man, shut your wicked mouth. You sat there and ate that damn potato salad. She got pork in the oven. She baked ham. You ate turkey. You are wicked. You are a vile, wicked liar. Yah says, come out. You don't eat that damn ham. You don't eat that biscuits. You don't eat that mama day biscuits. I went to a man's house that suppose I've been teaching this since the 50s. And hell, they celebrating Father's Day. You want something to eat, Red? No, I don't want a damn thing. You could have Kobe beef, I wouldn't eat it. You could have Kobe beef, I wouldn't eat it. We celebrate mama's birthday, just come on. Something that's vile and wicked, you know she is. Unscrupulous. You sit down there and dine, and she become the attention of attraction. Then they pray, hold on, let's bless the food, Lord Jesus. And they're about popping brewies and drinking wine and their liquors and their licorice and they're drunk as dogs. That's the truth. Got ham and everything that Yah says this is an abomination, ham and swine's meat. And you sit there and you're part of that. Yeah, I'm going to get me some of them collard greens. Y'all ain't putting no pork in them. No, baby, we didn't do that because of you. We know you don't eat no pork, and yet they seasoned it with pork but took it out. You so damn gullible and so stupid. You're a jackass. Your big, greedy, fat belly doesn't give a damn. Yeah, I talk like that. Find someone else. You sit there and eat the damn collard greens and the potato salad. He doesn't know, baby. Just take that out because he's coming. Take the ham out. You know he don't like that. Now you just can't cook them greens without no ham. And he's so damn stupid with his God. His God of his belly loves that. It loves unclean things. Give me some of them. Give me some of them collard greens. I'm talking to you, Yisrael. Making it plain. He says, and I gave this horse space to Shub to repent. For idolatrous or her fornication, Revelation 2:21, and she repented not. I understood what the precious hope was saying last night, but she just did not understand the veracity of Torah. They're not going to repent. He's going to save the remnant. And you're not going to find them. And when you hear the proclamation of the voice of Yahshua HaMashiach, then you listen and you hear. And just stand still and be quiet. Yah says, Yahshua said this. He said, behold, does it say I? Is that Yahshua talking? Is it red? It's red in my book. He says, behold, I will cast her in a bed or a, this is what this word. Now, you have to kind of look and try to discover things. But this word, he said, I will cast her into a bed. It is arah, arash, arash. It means in the context, it is very clear it is a bed of death or a coffin. So that's what he means. He said, I'm going to put her on a bed. He said, I will cast her into a bed. And look at this now. And them that eat the damn swine offerings of mama's day. She has no birthday. She was birth. There's not a day, another day to celebrate. She was birth and that's it. She was birth and that's it. He said, I will not only her and them that commit adultery, those that commit this idolatry with her, and you that lay hands on her, you that participate, I will commit her and them who commit adultery with her into great trials, into great sarag, tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. He said, I'm going to put her there. And look what he says. Look what, is this Yahshua in verse 23? Well, he will never do it. He said, and I will kill. He said, I will harak. Does it say I will kill? Well, I know the new model translator would say that I will afflict this up. But Yahshua said, I will harak. I will exterminate. I will destroy. I will butcher. Is that Yahshua talking? He doesn't talk like that. You jackasses and cowards. Is that Yahshua? Is this the Brit Hadassah, the new covenant? New covenant? Oh, he just love. Is he still love? Did he say I will kill her? Sure, he said it. Did he say that? Did he say that? Is it red in your book? Is it red in your book, Yosef? Is it writing red? Did he say, I will kill? Is this Yahshua talking? He said, I will kill. Damn it, he doesn't talk like you. He said, their gods damn them all. God damn, like Jeremiah, right? kill your babies. I'm going to kill you all. Look what he says now. He says, I will harag. I will harag. Damn it. I gave you time and you still haven't repented. He says, I'm going to kill you. You dirty beasts, you bastards. Oh, no. Well, I'd rather him call me a bastard and I live than to tell me I'm going to kill you. I'm going to cast you into a bed of affliction. Believe me, I'd rather him say that. That's all right. It's making sense. Well, I got some more stuff to add. That's all right. Give me a little time. We got a few minutes. Yahshua said, and I will kill, I will destroy, I will murder. That's what harag is. I will harag. I will harag. They will be just like a rag. I will kill, I will destroy, I will annihilate, I will kill. I will kill her children. I will kill her bane. I will kill her children. Yah will never do that unless there's pattern to this. This doesn't mean a damn thing, does it? Unless there's a pattern of this kind of action where he killed babies. This little child right here, Sariah, where is he? Asleep. And Ashna and Kilyaya, I get it right. They are children. They're bane. But they're not what the scripture called tithe. When she produced that, when they bring that little one out, that would be what we call a taf. A taf. A taf. It is one that is held in the arm. You don't have to hold in the arms. I get to hold her, she gets with me. Yeah! Peppermint! Peppermint! No. Yeah, I'm a peppermint! Peppermint! No. No peppermint. She said, yeah! Peppermint! All right, here's one for you and give your sister one. Stop that. And so she is not what you will call a taf. I want to explain that, all right? Yah says, Yahshua said, I'm going to kill that whore. She's a damn dirty slut. She's a prostitute that spread diseases. I'm going to put her to bed affliction, and I will kill her children with muth. Not mavith, I'm going to execute them. He said, with muth. I'm going to execute. When he moves, it is an execution. He said, I'm going to kill them with death. He said, and all the congregation shall know that I am he which searches the reins of the Lev, of the Levim, and I will give every man one of you according to your what? Your works. That's what he's going to do. That's why he says, I know you hate all workers of iniquity. You're working outside of the parameter of the Torah. He's going to kill you. You're working outside of his name. His name is in the Torah. He's going to kill you. He's going to kill you. I don't care if it's your mom or your dad. I don't care if your dad is 95. I don't care if he's 105. He may be sweet to you, but he's not sweet to Yah. I don't care if your daughter's 19. She may be sweet to you, but she's not sweet to Yah. You may call her sweet, but to Yah, she is not sweet. She's a bitter vial. She's a bitter thing. Your son may be nice. You love him, but Yah doesn't love him. He hates him. Your son hates Yah. He's Yah's enemy. You say Yah's your father. You tell me. Do you think that I hear my father stands with me? You think I'm going to be a friend of those that are an enemy to my father? You can't. I will not. You think I'm going to do that? You think I'm going to befriend someone that I know your enemy and my enemy, yeah? You think I'm going to call them and say, well, you know, just keep on. No, go to hell. You're an enemy of the house of Yisrael. You're an enemy of the labor of God. You're going to befriend that. You're going to fellowship. You're going to walk in that. You are sick, damn creature. You think I'm going to befriend them, those that have smitten and done you wrong, and they're your enemies? There is no comfort for you. You think I'm going to, huh? With duplicity, I say, all right, my acha, shimri, you are right. And your enemies comfort them? Nah. That we say they're your enemies, and they're my enemies. Now that stands true with me on that. You're an enemy of Yah, you're my enemy. I don't care if it's my mother, my natural brothers, they are my enemies. I have no biological children, but I know one thing. I know the kind of man I am. I know the type person I am. They hate it. If I had a daughter that dressed like a little damn whore, I would tell her just like that, you are, get out of my face, you dirty whore. I don't care what she says. I don't care what she thinks. Get away from me. Don't you ever, if you ever come around me, you better dress appropriately. Hallelujah. And I would say to my woman, I don't give a damn about your shallow emotions.
You will not strengthen the arm of this filthy whore. You didn't train her that way unless you did. Get out of my house. You're not welcome here. Oh, that's so cold. You don't know what coldness is. I will show you cold. You think I'm cold. I will show you what coldness is, all right? Is that Yahshua say he's going to kill them? Oh, I didn't think Yahshua would. Oh, no, no. He just left. Who was that one that came out with the song Lionel Richard? For Jesus is love. Everybody brought it up. You could slow drag on the dance on the whole floor with that, and they played in the whole houses. Talk to me. It is the truth. But this is the Yahshua here. The damn Jesus doesn't talk like that. Yahshua said, I'm going to kill you, you dirty hoe. He's killing all whores. He said, no, no, hold up, hold up. I know I'm not saying this to you, Abba, but this is what you're placing in my hand. You put them all in my hand, didn't you not? I lost none but the one of perdition. He said, I'm going to kill the dirty hoe, you slut. I'm going to kill them. And tell you what, I'm going to kill your children and those that congregate with you. I'm going to kill them all. That's Yahshua talking. Well, you misinterpreting that, man. No, I'm reading it like it is. You damnable ignoramus and liar. Nobody wants to hear like this, do they? Can I move on a little bit? Why is he going to do this? There must be patterns. Hallelujah. Look in Shemoth and Exodus quickly. I would have finished this today, and I am all right. Hallelujah. In the book of Exodus chapter 22, verse 20, this is when He promised, or his instructions unto Yisra'el as they were brought into the land of Ka'an, and the promises unto them. And this is what he commanded them in the book of Exodus 22:20. He says, you that Zabach, can I use sacrifices, Zachin Yeramiah? Because when they do that to these idols, they're not offering the Zabach unto Yah. And you that sacrifice to the gods, unless you zabach unto Yah only, Yah says he shall utterly destroy. Does it say that? He will completely annihilate. When you lift up the damn name of Jesus, he's going to destroy you. When you lift up God, he's going to destroy you. When you offer up unto the gods of the belly or the family heritage, when you denounce Yisra'el, the family that we are Ikad in Yahshua HaMashiach, Yah says, I'm going to destroy you. I am going to decimate. I'm going to desecrate. I'm going to bring you to the altar, utterly ruins. I'm going to destroy. He said, you shall neither, look at this, you shall never vex or not treat violently a stranger, a gay, an alien, one that sojourns, one that has no right to the house of Yisra'el. You don't treat them wrong. You don't vex them. You don't cause them to be oppressed. He says, nor oppress him, for you were strangers in the land of Mizraim. We're strangers in this land. So why should we? I am not going to treat the Mexicans wrong. I don't give a damn whether they're legal or illegal. I'm not going to intrigue them wrong. I'm not going to look at them as though that he is an illegal. I'm not going to look at them with distaste because, hell, they pop out the food stamp card and swipe that. Well, if you go that night, you'll see them of all kinds of shapes and colors that are popping them out and swiping it. I'm not going to treat them that way because we want to call them strangers in this land. And as though that they are robbing, hell, you are living fat because they're working. And your damn Social Security money is coming because they're laboring and working for nothing and have no damn heritage in this damn lie of deception. I like to pull that out for all my Akanahota that are born Mexicans in this dirty whore America. Hallelujah. So I don't look at them funny. And so when they see me, they see a big man and they tend more. They do. They look at me and how you doing? I don't make them feel out of place with me. I don't make them feel that way. I don't make them feel that way. I don't do them like that. I don't say that we don't never talk about who's been here illegal. I don't never talk about it.
Hell, the ones that are here are illegal. They robbed and stole and killed and butchered. And we want to look at it like that. They open up their prison factories and the bombs and the strufflers and the wicked ones, they poured them to the shores here. And they knew how to kill and to rob and to infest with diseases. So I don't look at the Mexicans. I don't look at them like that. I don't look at those as though that they are illegal. They're just as legal as I am here. My rights are not in this land, but in the land of New Jerusalem. And the city's going to be big enough for 1,000 miles this way, 1,000. It will be 4,000 square miles. It shall encompass all Israel. So I'm not going to look at them like that. I'm not going to treat them like that. You can't. I will not. I won't do them like that. They're taking the job. They're not taking one damn job you would work. I was saying to Yosef, I said, can you imagine we were in the bean field? I said, this is tough. Every time you turn around, you're wiping, man. I said, can you imagine those that are the Mexican descent and those that are migrants? They work the field all day long, bending down, picking beans. And their babies, he said, huh? The children? I didn't even answer, yo, you know. There are babies like that out there because they can pick a few beans. When I was a young lad like that, I picked cotton. I was in the cotton field. A handful added to that sack. There are babies out there. I don't care how big. There are little ones like that. They are in the bean field picking. That's why they're trying to pass. They don't want the law to pass no child labor law. Why? Because, hell, you cannot eat your Del Monte peas or your Del Monte beans. You think I'm going to abuse the people like that? I don't want a job all day in the damn bean field. I don't want that job. It's hard work. It's backbreaking. It's brutal. You work all day for nothing. And you think I'm going to look at those people strange or treat them falsely? I will not do them like that. Damn you if you do it. You got watermelons eating there out there in the field all day picking melons. Cantaloupes. We getting fat like hogs. It is the truth. I don't even know why I went that way, but that's all right. It's tough. And all right. Well, I guess that's why that Mexican woman came to us. She could sense, well, he's not like the other ones. She doesn't look like that. There's a charm about her that's different. You say what you want to. You can mock it. But I see that all the time. I don't care if they don't say anything about me. I don't care if they don't say anything about her. It makes me no different. There's some, they say something about me like he is too crazy looking. I don't mind that. You're not like the people here. You don't look. You don't dress. Or where you're from. My issue is that we're from Jefferson, South Carolina. Oh, no. You don't look. You don't even dress. And I'm watching this woman. She, you know, I'm not saying, we're sick people. And I watch her how she just wanted to get close to my issue. Just the woman was all up on her. You don't find Mexicans that because it's the media and this nation that's created an opposition between those of the diasporas and the Mexicans. To say they're taking jobs that you would get. You're not working the bean field, man. You're not going out there working, picking the watermelon. That's some backbreaking work. That's backbreaking when we go out there and harvest 200 melons. Can you imagine all day long harvesting melons? There are places in California whereby there are fields that are hundreds and hundreds, thousands of acres. Or you think they got a machine to cut broccoli you see in the stores? They are out there laboring and working. I will not intrigue them that way. They're working the jobs where nobody's going to work. Within their little construct, one open a store, another one do that. They're not all there, no more than all the people of the diaspora are out robbing and stealing. They're not selling drugs. There are people here that are honestly trying to pan out a living. And I will not condemn them for that. I'm not upset with them. I'm not. And the damn media has twisted your mind to act like that and make you think. I'm not upset with those people. Your baby's hungry, your children. You're in utter poverty because of the greed of this damn nation and the rich elites of the world. They have oppressed your babies and put them like that. And you're trying to find a way you can make a few dollars just to save a little money and build a shack. They're not trying to build a $5 million mansion. It would a place, if it's an earthen floor, and buy a few cattle and some chickens and raise a little piece of land that can grow a little maize and a little food. You think I will condemn a people because of that? I will not. Even if they were still, I will not. If they were still food to feed their babies, you don't even condemn that man for that. Different between he's stealing food or stealing something for a drug habit, but he's still food for his baby. Not all of them are cutthroats and robbers. I don't buy that damn lie.
I want to finish up here, Ark. Hallelujah. You don't oppress the stranger. In verse 22, you should not afflict the widow or the fatherless child. You don't take advantage of the true widows. What is a true widow? She watches and she takes care of those. She watches the stranger's feet. These women, they call themselves widows. The first thing they begin to do is burn in their lust. Nasty. They're not even clean with their bodies. First thing they want to do is start burning in their lust and look for a man. They'll never find a man. They'll find something filthy as they are. First thing they want to do is burn in their lust. They're not even, and the Torah talks about that. When they began to grow angry and wanton against Yah, then they will begin to seek something to satisfy their flesh. And they'll try to dress like some young teeny bopping whore, and they're ugly, unattractive. They get dressing up this way, it's going to draw some man's attention. It will draw a freak like you, but it will never draw a man. A man looks for something that is much more beautiful than one because she got hair hanging down her back. He's not even looking at that. Her hair can be bald as his head. There's a beauty that accentuates beauty that you don't just find. She has a charm that is not expressed and what she thinks she is fly. It's not that way, Yisrael. If you will listen to a man and understand that, you will never fight a man that way. You fight a boy. An effeminate boy too. Move it on quickly. He says in verse 23, if you afflict them in any wise, and they cry at all to me, I will surely hear their cry. And Yah says, am I off my burning king wrath, my anger shall wax hot. And Yah says, and I will kill you. He says, I'm going to kill you. Is this Yah talking? Is Yahshua the word of Yah? Yeah. Did he not say, I'm going to kill Jezebel and your children too? Yeah. Yah said, I will kill you with the sword. He said, and your wives shall be widows and your children shall be fatherless. You treat the fatherless children wrong? He said, I'm going to kill you. Well, you know, there are children that needs help. There are children that have been brought under and birthed under a cursed law of Yah. And their minds are not going to be changed. I don't care what you can pray all day long. We try to draw upon an emotions that we think is based in truth, but it's not the emotions of Yah, Yisrael. He said, I'm going to kill you men if you treat them wrong. I'm going to kill you and your children are going to be fatherless. Are not our children fatherless today? You don't find men nowhere today. I don't care what nationality of people you look upon. They're not there. And the women can be bought a dime or a nickel, 2 cents a dozen. Every kind of wicked sexual innuendo, every kind of concept, a man can get that. Because he knows he cannot find a woman. Her price is valuable. She's a jewel. Walk upright, women. Quit hunching down. Quit mincing, as Bishop would say. Walk upright. Like Miss Mickle taught the women. She taught them to walk. Miss Mickle taught the women how to walk. And she was a heavy woman. I remember Miss Mickle. She always wore shoes back then with heels about like that. She was somewhat what we would call portly, you know, kind of large. But she would teach them, hold your head up, and you walk like this. And she taught them how to walk. And she would put a book on their head. And of course, we as the young boys, we were laughing. It was silly to us. But it was a beauty to the way Miss Mickle taught the girls how to walk. How to be ladylike, not bowing down and all hunched down and crunched down. Come on. And that's not how to walk. You walk upright and erect. Talk to me, Yisrael. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You might as well love me. He said, your wives are going to be widowless, and your children shall be childless. There's something important I want to read. I want to show you an aspect of Yah, Yahshua, quickly.
We know who Baruch was and is. He was the pen of Jeremiah. He was the secretary, was he not? Sure he was. So in the second book of Baruch, y'all please take a chance and read this. Here's a prophecy or the vision of the time that we're in. There's some metaphoric speech here, but I will explain the metaphor to you, all right? The speech that represents a not only figurative, but an absolute. Does that make sense? That's what a metaphor is. It paints a picture in the abstract, but it shows us the reality of that when it is revealed to the mind. Is that better? All right, then. It is the truth. He says here in Second Baruch, chapter 7, verse 70, verse 1. I want to read this. I want to read chapter 70, 71, 72. I want to read. Follow me along, all right? You don't have the book of Baruch, then you, what you do is that you write this down and read it tonight. Read it this evening. You're not doing anything but sitting there eating cheese pops, so read it. Hallelujah. Second Baruch, 71. It says, therefore, hear the exposition of the last black waters, which will come after the black waters. This is the word. We know the word. This is Yah here. Now, the black waters of this Hoshek, it is a water. Yahshua is the living crystal water of Yah. When we drink this water, it sees to the depth of our heart. This is a blackness that shall prevail and overcome the whole world. This is what this vision is about, is the Hoshek, or the darkness that shall set in. And he said, this is the word. And if you look at that end, in the writings of Baruch, he capitalized the word, W-R-D, or this is the revelation of Yahshua HaMashiach. Now, if it's not so, then we will find it as we read. This is the word. He is the word that was made flesh. He said, behold, the days are coming, and it will happen when the time of the world has ripened, when everything has lined up in the order that Yah intends, when everything is ripened. He said, and the harvest of the seed, and the harvest of the seed of the evil ones, and the tough ones have come, that Yahweh, the mighty one, will cause to come over the earth, and its inhabitants and its rulers shall be confusion of spirit and amazement of love. And they shall hate one another and provoke one another to fight. Can I explain that? He said, there's a season and a time whereby darkness, the seed of those that are birthed for the kingdom righteousness of Yah, and those that are the seed of the wrath, he said, will come a time that there shall be a great battle. And because he says they will fight a milchaya, a battle, because of the seed of the wicked that's trying to overthrow the Tzaddik. And there's a reason because of that. Yahshua spoke even in the last days in the book of Matityah 24. He speaks of a time, he says, and because iniquity shall abound, the Torahlessness man, he said, the love of many shall wax cold. It should be a cold love. He said, these things have come to pass because of Yah. He said, the love of many shall wax cold, or it shall be what the Torah of the Hebraic expression, it shall be a sinna, a coldness. Have you ever met people that you know that there's a coldness to them, and they embrace you, you know it's a coldness? I hate that. They show you, they tell you they love you, phoniness and pretense and fakeism. I hate that. I hate fake people. I hate fake. Don't mess with me. Get away from me. Don't even look at me. Don't even talk to me. I don't like nobody fake. I'd rather you be genuine. I don't care what you are. Just be genuine. Don't be fake with me. I'm not a fakey bakey. I'm not a fake bakey. I'm not fake in any aspect. What you see is what you get. I'm real. I confess all the time. You're just not around me. I did this, actually. Yosipia, this what I'm not going to lie to you. This is what I did. I took $50. I bought this and I bought that. Yeah, that's what I did. Do I do that all the time? All the time. I'm not a fakey. I'm not a flaky flake. That I'm not. I'm real. I had nothing. Hallelujah. And so they will fight one another. The reason they will fight one another, because iniquity shall abound. And their low shall, and they should have this false thing they call sinai. It shall be cold. It is a dubious thing. It's a coldness. Oh, I love you, baby. And then you know there is nothing genuine. There's fake. It's phony. You embrace me and you know it's not real. That's wrong. When I got in opposition with a man, I don't even embrace him. I say, no, I'm not going to embrace you. That's the way I am. You can, but I will not. That's something in your heart is, brother, you're not even embrace the altar. Come to our Yah's altar and get it right, and then you embrace that to be a damn hypocrite. Yeah. You carry all in your heart against one, you're going to hell. And those that continue to do that, they're sick, they're diseased in their mind. Their minds are Kali is dressed their mind. Their minds are diseased. They're stupid as hell. They're sick. They can't get over it. And they're going to die that way. And woe unto them. Woe unto them. As much as we have opportunity, we do right by all men. I don't care who it is. Stranger, proselyte. I don't care if it's a Mexican, it's a Jew, it's a Caucasian, it's a black man, an African. Okay, who he is. Scandinavian, Gentile. You do right by the man. You don't try to cheat him. You do right. Moving quickly, I want to close here. It says in verse 3 in 2 Baruch, and the despise with rule over the honorable and the unworthy, raise them themselves up to be, they wanted to be brilliantly and outstanding, illustrious. Baruch 74. And many will be delivered to the few. So the masses that we are today, we're under control of the few, are we not? Those who were nothing will rule over the strong, and the poor will be greater in number than the rich. And the impious, those that are blasphemous and sacrilege against Yah, will exalt themselves over the brave. The wise will be silent. The wise men today, they're silent because they're foolish. And the foolish will speak. And the thoughts of men will not be realized then, nor the counsel of the strong, and the hope of those who hope will be realized, or the tikvah. Then it will happen when those things occur. What will happen? Then this profound revelation. Then it will happen when those things occur which has been said before and will come to pass, that confusion will fall upon all men. This is a confused generation. Because there's envy and strife, and where envy and strife is, there's confusion and every evil work. When you find a man that is envious, he's full of strife, he's envious, he's a weak, cowardly, beggary beast. And Yah commands us, that needs to be taught, you should never, as Yisrael, beg. That's why David said, I've been young and I've been old. He said, I've been young and old, but I've never seen the righteous forsaken, or the seed of Yisrael begging for it. I beg no man. Beg for no offerings, beg nothing. Hallelujah. He said, some will fall into war, verse 6, and others will perish with tribulation, and against others of them will be troubled by their own. 2 Baruch 70, verse 7. Yahweh the Most High will then give a sign. He will give an oath to those nations which he has prepared before, their nations that Yah has prepared for the slaughter and death. And they will come and wage war with the rulers who will then remain. And it will happen that everyone who saves himself from the war will die by the earthquake. If we seek to save our lives, we're going to lose it. So they will try to save their lives, but they're going to die in the earthquake. And he who save himself from the earthquake will be burned by the fire. And who will save himself from the fire will perish by famine. Why is that? Because these are the four sword judgments of Yah. He's going to kill. He's a killing machine. He's a killer. Yahshua's a killer. He's a born killer. He's a born killer of the enemies of Yah. Is not Yah a man of war? Is not he a man of war? And it will happen that everyone who will deliver himself and escape from all these things which have been said before, both those who have won and those who have overcome. Listen to this. All those have delivered themselves. All those have escaped. This is what Yah says. And they think they've gotten by. This is the catalyst here in 2 Baruch 79. All those that think they've gotten by. He said, and that all will be delivered into the hands of my servant, the anointed one. Who is that? That's Yahshua. Even in the writing, it is capitalized. He said, I'm going to deliver all of them into the hands of Yahshua. Now listen to this. For the whole earth will devour its inhabitants. And the Kadosh land will have mercy on its own and will protect its inhabitants in that time. We shall be, and Yahshua must be our hiding place. We must hide ourselves in the Torah until the indignation is passed over. But listen, Yisrael, he said, this is the vision which have been seen. And it is the explanation, for I have come to tell you these things, since your prayers have been heard by Yah, the Most High. So he is saying, Baruch, unto Yisrael, since you have cried out unto Yah, Yah is bringing the revelation unto Baruch, what things shall be and what shall happen. Or this is the vision or the interpretation of the vision. Second Baruch 72 and 1. I just read 71, 1 and 2. It was only two verses in Baruch 71. Now Baruch 72, 1. Now this is the catalyst. Yah says, now hear also about the bright waters, Yahshua, this living water, the bright waters, which come at the end after those black ones. There's a lively living water that shall flow in the veins of the remnant of Yisrael after this dark water or this dark time has captivated, enslaved many. But then there's a refreshing water in Yahshua, the bright water that shall come. It says, this is the word. Yahshua is the word. This is the word. After the signs have come of which I have spoken to you before, when the nations are moved and the time, listen now, the time of my anointed one come, Yahshua will call all nations, and some of them he will spare. Some of the nations he's going to spare. There are nations that he's going to spare because of how they have interacted with Yisrael. Some of them he will spare, some of them he will spare, some of them he will spare, and others he will harak. He's going to kill them. Is he not the anointed one of Yah? Yes. Is Yahshua not the anointed one? Yes. You can buy it any way you want to. There are nations he's going to spare, and he tells us the integrity of the nations he's going to spare. He's saying there's some he's going to kill. He's going to kill babies. He's going to kill mamas. He's going to kill daddies. He's going to kill them all. Old, blind, crippled. He's going to kill them all. Some nations. The firstborn that he killed all, if they were the firstborn, whether they were old, young, blind, crippled, or crazy, he killed them. He said others he will kill. These things will befall the nations which will be spared by him. Every nation which has not known Yisrael and which have not trodden down the seed of Yaakov will live. And so there are people that have never did Yisrael wrong. The people have been scattered abroad. They have never done them wrong. He said, those nations are going to live. Those people I'm not going to kill, but the bastards that have done them wrong, the bastards that have caused atrocity to fall upon them, they have caused them to be in great bondage of slavery and bound. He said, I'm going to kill them, their babies. I'm killing them all. That's Yahshua talking. He tells us who he is going to spare, the nations that have not done Yisrael wrong. This is right here. You don't have to buy it, but it's still the truth. This is an aspect of Yah we don't hear teach in these whorehouses. And this is because some from all nations have been subject to your people. And all those now who have ruled over you or have known you will be delivered up to the sword. Those nations have ruled over Yisrael, have trodden them down, have done you wrong, have oppressed you, have robbed you, have stole your labor. Yahshua said, I'm going to kill them. They're going to be delivered up to the sword. I'm going to kill them all. I'm going to bring them down to hell. He's going to kill. Yahshua is a killing machine. Let nobody hit you. He is the word. And it's the power of that word that kill and destroy. One last thing I want to close with here in the book of Hosea. I'm somewhat tired. There's more, but I want to close here. Two things I want to close with. Here in the book of Hosea quickly. The judgment of Yah upon Yisrael. Hosea chapter 9 verse 11. Quickly, he says, as for Ephraim, that's Yisrael, that's another name for Yisrael. As for Ephraim, the splendor shall fly away like a bird. The beauty of Yisrael, where is it? Our women are not beautiful. Our men are not beautiful. Our children are not beautiful. The women dress their baby girls like whores, tight dresses on their little eyes, and trying to sell them to the pedophile. They're stupid, bimbo harlots, what they are. I don't take one damn word back. They try to inspire them with aspiration. Inspiration of the world is wrong. She is not Kodesh. The dad is a weak, fledgling, effeminate. I like to talk like this to get folks mad at me, aroused. I do. But the book talks like this. Hallelujah. As for Ephraim, the splendor shall fly away like the bird from the birth and from the womb and from the conception. Though they bring up their children, is this Yah talking here? Yah says, yet I will shakol, I will breathe, I will kill them. I'm going to abort them in the womb. 3,000 plus babies of the diaspora, of the women of the dark hills, skin, they abort babies every week. 2,400. They kill babies every week like dogs. They kill babies every week. You have a society that pressure them to become actually active sexually. And then they promote killing the baby for the rich bastards to make more money. To take that and make makeup, you women putting that damn mess on your faces. Where they take these fetuses or babies and take, what is that other thing that comes out of the woman? The placenta. And these rich Jezebel whores are trying to revive and rejuvenate their old crackly, wicked, dirty skin. You damn foolish jackasses, strengthen that. You sell your babies all day to a damn tube that lies to them. You so damn dumb, you love it too. You fat belly, lazy men sit there all day and watch it, lusting after some damn whore. You have no power to show intimacy with your wife. You jackass. You're not even a man. You're not even an effeminate. I don't take a word back. If it's you, it's you. You're not even intimate with your wife, and you get intimate in your mind with a dirty slut that will sleep with a dog. You stupid fool. Hallelujah. Though they bring up children, I will bereave them. That there shall not be a man left. Where do you find a man today? He said, I'm going to kill all the math. The men, the babies, they are aborting these baby boys. They're killing them like dogs. And the ones that are left, this effeminate society, the faggites, are making them faggots. Because a woman has no husband, because the only thing she can instill in that child are the tendons of a woman. That's the truth. In my days, as I was talking to Zaki and Shimon, we had uncles, even though they may have been wicked, they were men. You understand, they were men, they were strong men, in the sense that they would jack you up. If they saw you trying to act like a sissy, they would jack you up. I don't know, his name was Joe Dean Roberts. We call him Uncle Pete. He would look at him, he was about 6'5", 6'6". He was tall, slender. He was tall, man. He was a tall man. And he would look at me, his eyes was red. He was black as Zachin Benjamin. Black too, black. It's amazing because black as he was, the female counterpart loved him. As black as that man was, they loved him. You understand? The stupid idea because of the color of your skin. And he would look at me and those eyes would get red as blood. He scared me. They called my mother Fatty. She was a little old thing, but that's what they call her, Fatty. He would say to me, David, and if that was something to make him cry, things like that would. He said, if you ever do Fatty wrong, I'll kill you. And I knew he would kill you because he had killed the man before. I knew he would kill you. He didn't play. I knew he would kill you because he was always loaded. He was always cocked and he was ready. He would cut your head off. He said, I will kill you. And I knew Uncle Joe Dean, Uncle Pete. And I never in all my life I disrespect Uncle Pete. Never. We sat down, drank together and did things together, but I never disrespected. Never in all my life. He said, I will kill you. And even in the midst of all that, he said, I will kill you, David. If you ever do your mama wrong, I will kill you. He said, I will kill you. I will go to prison for the rest of my life. But I will kill you. And I knew that he would kill you. I knew that. So at least we as young men, we had a sense of place and protection and what we should protect. These boys today, the mama has, they have stayed on the shad, on the titty of their mama so long, they're boys. They've stayed on the titty nipple so long, they're boys. Well, don't say that to him, my grandmama. That's it. He didn't mean it. Just straighten the damn knucklehead out. I will, man. That touches chords when I talk like that. I know it does. Hallelujah. He said, and there shall be no man left. Yes, woe also to them when I depart from them. Hosea 9:13. Ephraim I saw as Tyrus. Is planted in the pleasant place, but Ephraim shall bring forth his children to the murderer. They're going to have babies for the murderers. Don't we see on the streets here in the cities? Detroit, Chicago, New York, Los Angeles. Are they not bringing forth their babies to the murderers? cripping and blooding and crip walking and the blood walk? Are they not doing that? The baby's heron in the rich, what we call the enclaves of the upper crescent class, the drug addicts and babies, the daughters of whores and pumping babies like damn dogs and aborting them. They're fleazy little whores, have no satisfaction with man, that they love beasts and every kind of strange thing. I'm going to talk like that to keep our children from that. Hallelujah. It says in verse 14, give them, O Yah, what you will give. Now he is crying unto Yahushua, you give them what they should give. He said, give them a miscarrying, a shachol, a barren, a miscarrying womb, and give them dry breasts. Are they putting the babies on the titties today? They are aborting babies away. That's what shachol is. They are aborting babies away. They don't even give them titty milk. They give them Similac. Their babies are born with birth defects and diseases because they're feeding these damn chemicals in their minds and killing them. Give them dry breasts. Their titties drop after a week. Even a damn beast of the field, titties don't drop like that. Make their shaft to be dried. He said, all their wickedness in Gilgal, for there I hated them. This is Yah talking. I hated them. All their wickedness, Yah said, I hated them. All their wickedness, he hate the wicked. I hated them. For the wickedness of their doing, I will drive them out of my house. Is this Yah talking? I will drive them out of my bed. Did he say I hated them? Did Yah say I hated them? Is Yahshua the word of Yah? Is this not Yahshua speaking? Here, sure it is. For all of their wickedness, their Torah lessness, you defy the Torah. This is a generation that doesn't give a damn about Yah. He tell us what things that are olam viat forever before us, and we don't give a damn, Yisrael, Yah. He said, because of all the wickedness in a pleasant place, in a place where they had water, you can bathe, you can sit on a stool and defecate. You got air conditioning, you got fans, and you don't give a damn, you still do wickedly. Yahshua says, I hate them bastards, I hate them. Yah says, I'm going to drive them from my house. I will love them no more. Does it say that? Yes. I will love them no more. For he is love. Yah says, I will not love those bastards. To the fourth generation, I'm going to curse them all. Let them die. He said, all of their princes are revolters. They are sarah. They are stubborn and rebellious. Ephraim, he said, it is Nacha. I have smitten them with diseases. Their root is dried up. They bear no fruit. We are not fruit bearing today. We don't bear the peri. He says, yes, though they bring forth, yet Yah says, I will kill them. I will slay. I will mutha. I will execute them. He said, I will kill even the beloved of the fruit of their womb. That's Yah talking. This is Yahshua here. Is he the word made flesh? He said, damn it, I'm going to kill them. Give you an assignment to read. You read Bimidbar, chapter 16, 23 to 34. Just read that tonight. Make sure you read it before you go to bed. Verse 17, if Yah my Abba will cast them away, why? Because they did not listen to him. And they shall wander or nada among the nations or heathens. I want to close with this one verse here as Hannah began to sing for the great victory over the enemies among Yisrael. This is one of the stanzas of that song. It is found in 1 Shemuyah, 1 Samuel, verse 2. This is her song right here. This is what Hannah began to sing for the great victory over the Oye, the enemies of Yah, or the Ar, those that plot against Yah. She says here in 1 Samuel 2:6, when you get that, say amen. 1 Samuel 2:6, anyone has that? Amen. All right. 1 Shemuyah 2:6. Is this Yah here? I want you to, is Yahshua the word of Yah? Yes. It says, Yah kills and Yah makes alive. Yah muth, he execute. Is that him? Yes. Yah kills and Yah makes alive. He brings down to the grave. And he also calls to rise up like he did Yahshua. He is a killing machine. Don't ever forget that. Straight talk from the book. No pretense. Nothing to smooth it out. But this is straight talk from the book. May the riches of Yah rest upon you. Or someone send me an email today and send an offering, you that are out listening.
that your house has been enriched and blessed. Send an offering to him. We need a few pieces of equipment, and it's going to cost around $300-$400. Send that. We're not beggars, but send. You listen. You've been blessed, your home, strength. Send an offering. Hallelujah. And help us get that. We need that. There's some equipment we need to strengthen the broadcast, to make it, to enhance it to a greater degree. Send an offering. Hallelujah. We're not begging for one penny, but it will bless you to give. They give to T.D. Jakes, don't they? He drives a Bentley. His car costs more than, the tires on his car cost more than all my possessions. I don't have a damn thing. He wears $100,000 watches. That's a fool there. $3,000 shoes. That's a real fool. $3,000, I can get a wardrobe for 2 years. That's right. I give me 5-6-pair shoes, 10-12 suits, 15. 3-4 nice watches, and brims the match with all that. I could. Fact. May Yabarak, be strong, Yisrael. Yeah, I said that way. Be strong. Be encouraged in Yahshua HaMashiach. Yah kills Yisrael. Let no one tell you he doesn't. And Yahshua is his Torah. He is the Word made flesh. So you cannot have that what Shemuel said, Shemuya said, and that's not what Yahshua represents. These little weak fledgling, little hypocritical hypocrites, weak that don't love Torah, they don't teach that. So anything rides with them. They don't confront anything that offends Yah. You must confront it. Yah barak you all. We enjoyed you all today. Let us stand to our feet, Yisrael. That's all right. It is Yah's day. This is Yah's day, his Shabbat. You turn toward Yerushalayim and the blessed place of Yah's riches. In all things we do, barak you, Yah. In Yahshua's name, we pray for those that were not joined with us in service today. Look upon their situation, their homes. We pray for Yisrael to guide and teach us in all things. Feed us, Yah, with your truth. We need it. We shall continue on Gileana, Revelation 13. What does it mean? That no man will be able to buy and sell. We must have revelation of that. You must reveal that to your simple messengers. We shall see, Yah, as you grant us wisdom of that on next Shabbat. May your riches rest upon all those that join us, even our enemies. We pray for them. In Yahshua's mighty name, guide us this day and give us rest. Shalom in Yahshua is our prayer. And with that, our hearts rejoice with fatness. We shout hallelujah. 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 Yabarak Yisrael. Hallelujah.